High School Football on Backcountry TV. Brought to you by Pioneer Flooring and Design, ERA Realty Center, Cedar City Motor Company, Tink's Superior Auto Parts, Mike Haight Insurance Agency, Gem Awards, Bobby's Upholstery, the Cedar City Chamber of Commerce, All About Smiles, Ron's Sporting Goods, Riffles, Midtown Tire and Auto, and Community Auto Center.
We're back on Backcountry TV on the pregame show, and I'm with Josh Bennett. Coach, you didn't play last week, and it's a little out of the routine nonetheless. Football can be a tough sport, a lot of bumps and bruises and dings, and I'm sure that was time well spent healing those up.
Yeah, it was a good week off. I mean, we still did, you know, some things to keep the kids fresh, but we definitely used that week as an opportunity to heal up. And, you know, we've had quite a few injuries, and, you know, I feel like we're a more healthy team going into tonight. So,
how would you characterize the practices the last 2 weeks?
Been great.
Very active?
Yeah, it's been great. Even we've had some kids go down a few weeks ago that were key players, and, you know, I've been impressed with how our kids have stepped up and how hard they've been practicing. And, you know, and I think we've had, you know, three of our best weeks of practice. Mm-hmm. So,
getting healed up is great, but football can be a timing sport too, so you want to stay in game form, but would you have any concerns about that at all?
No, I mean, I think it's just how you practice. I mean, we did some time, you know, especially this week where we did a little bit of contact. Mm-hmm. We just started to limit it a little bit. I think you have to do that when you get to this point in the season, you know, so we can try to peak at the right time. But we still did some hitting in practice to where, you know, we can keep these guys in game shape and be ready to go tonight. So,
speaking of timing, I was impressed with the way Braden came out and ran the offense last game against Hurricane. It looked like they'd been working together all year long in that offense.
Yeah, I mean, he stepped right in. He's got great leadership. He's a very mentally tough kid. I mean, good learner. He stepped right in and, you know, really led our offense. We had to adjust some things a little bit. And, man, we were very impressed, and we're hoping we get that same effort tonight. So,
coming down to the final game of the regular season, it's a game with implications, which I guess you always expect in this region. Mm-hmm. But coming down to the final game, it's nice to be playing for something.
Oh, yeah, it's awesome. Yeah, it's definitely a motivational thing. The kids have earned this opportunity to play here and, you know, play for a higher seed in the playoffs. And, you know, we preached from day one that we want to be playing our best football this time of the year, and so we're hoping that we can start hitting our stride tonight. So,
yeah, we obviously have plenty to play for, plenty of meaning to play for, and this Pineview team is in the same position that they've got something to play for as well. Mm-hmm. Talk a little bit about what we can expect.
Yeah, you know, see a dogfight tonight. I think it's really going to come down to who wants it more. I mean, definitely mistakes are going to play a key. You know, who can make the less mistakes. You know, who can execute on both sides of the ball better. And, you know, we're hoping we can come out on top. So,
thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
We'll be right back.
Look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920. Southern Utah businesses, you can reach thousands of potential clients while supporting high school sports. Students and parents love to watch and cheer on the local teams. Call Brian at 435-590-3056 at Backcountry TV for your high school sports. DVDs of Cedar High and Canyon View football games are now available for just $20. Share your memories of high school sports with family and friends by ordering your copy today. Call 435-625-1217 to order. That's 435-625-1217.
Let's face it, buying a pre-owned vehicle can be a challenge. What if you could eliminate all the risk? Where? Cedar City Motor Company. Peace of mind comes in many forms, like the fact that your pre-owned vehicle has a 7-day money-back guarantee, a 30-day exchange policy, and you get one low price, plain and simple, always. And that means a no-regret, mistake-proof car buying experience. Cedar City Motor Company. We're a new company with a new philosophy.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Thank you all for tuning in, and welcome to tonight's high school football matchup between the Pine View Panthers and the Cedar High Redmen. Final night of the season. I'm Chris Holmes, and I'm here along with the coach, Cleve Weaver. Coach, as you might expect, it seems like every region game means something, and even down to the final game, there's a lot of meaning in tonight's game.
Yeah, we come in here tonight in a three-way tie for third with Hurricane and Snow Canyon, and since we all beat each other, there's no clear tiebreaker. So we kind of have to win this one tonight to make sure we can have a home playoff game, and then we can't, you know, this crazy region, who knows, Snow Canyon and Hurricane could win too. You never know. Up north they had Corner Canyon was fifth place. They come in and beat the first place team in their region. And then Clearfield hadn't won all year, and they beat the first place team in the region. Hadn't won all year. They were 0-9 going to the last game. So you can never count on anything in high school football. The teams are all, you know, there's a lot of parity to the whole thing. But the Redmen need to start strong and finish strong in this one. This has always been a tough place for the Redmen to play since Coach Hosner took this program over about, I don't know, how long has he been here, 17 years or something like that, about?
I was going to say close to 20.
Yeah,
he and
I went to college together, and every time I see him, I think, man, I hope I don't look that old, but I'm pretty certain I do.
With the week off, Cleve, it was a welcome rest, I've got to think.
Yeah, you know it was. It was a good time, I think, to take a break. They took Monday and Friday off of practice, so they really only practiced 3 days last week. Let the kids heal up, get them a little bit fresher. It boded very well. They played really well in practice the couple of days that I was able to watch them. They're really sharp and crisp. And Coach Bennett puts an emphasis on having a little bit of fun every week. Gives the players a chance to mock their position coaches. The boys aren't afraid to hit the coaches a little bit below the belt. But it's an entertaining part of practice, one that I've started to make time to go watch.
Looks like Pine View has won the toss, and we'll see here in a moment. Pine View has elected to defer to the second half, and therefore Cedar will be receiving to start this ball game, and they will defend the south goal here at Pine View High School. Opportunity also for some dings and bruises and things to heal up as well.
Well, absolutely. You know, you start practicing the last week in July this year, right after the 24th of July, and you go all the way to the middle of October, you know, before you have a break. That's a pretty long time. And a lot of bruises and things that really need some time and don't need anything hitting them. And they've healed up well. It worked out well for our younger teams. Our freshman team didn't win last night, but they played the best game of the year. Our JV team went double overtime with Pine View and lost. And just of note, our girls volleyball team last night beat Pine View 3-0. They were in second place. And so maybe that time off helped everybody at our school. The kids are crisp, they're sharp, they're on top of their game. I gave both teams, you know, we don't have an advantage over them because everybody had the week off, but Coach Espen has a good defensive plan against these guys, and I'm sure that Pineview has a good offensive and defensive plan against us. I think it's going to come down to, I think you'll see at the very beginning who prepared the best, and then in the second half you'll see who makes the best adjustments, and it's going to be an intense ball game. They want to stay in third place. They don't want to. They don't want to get bumped to fourth.
They want to travel.
And if someone else wins, and we win, then maybe they're fifth and they're on the road. So they're playing for everything we're playing for tonight: the chance to be third and to play at home, and then be on the opposite side of bracket as Desert Hills, as opposed to being in the same bracket as Dixie. And so there's a lot of implications here. A lot of seating. You know, in the last few years, so goes the 3A South, so goes the 3AA. You know what I'm saying there?
Yeah.
And so it's going to be an intense, well-played, hard-hitting ball game. Coach Sosner has a longtime staff here, some good friends. He's a good friend of mine. Coach Oscar on our sideline went to school with us as well. So a bunch of – it's kind of a friendly – combination. Only the people you like beating better than your enemies or your friends.
And, that's right.
And so that kind of has that ring to it. And the kids all know each other. They've been playing Little League and freshman, sophomore, JV football against each other for like 10 years now. So everybody knows everybody. It's going to be just who goes the hardest, the longest.
Opening kickoff is brought to you by Pioneer Floor Covering and Design Center in the Providence Center. If for Florida quality floor products, start with Pioneer Flooring, carpets, woods, laminates, tile, vinyl at 1166 Sage Drive in Cedar City, right next to Wingers. Here comes the kick. It's a long kick that's going to hit about 8 yards deep in the end zone for the touchback. So Cedar will start out at the 20-yard line to begin the ball game.
You know, and that's not a great place to start, always in the 20, but when it goes in the end zone, as a coach, you always kind of breathe a sigh of relief. Well, we know we're getting at the 20. We don't have to worry about us fumbling it. So we'll see what Coach Bennett has, see if he's going to go a little more of that two-back stuff tonight. With Garrett having, you know, 8 practices to get ready for this game, they may have a few extra things, a few wrinkles in here for us.
Travis Tate and Trent Maurer are the backs to each side of Braden Garrett in the shotgun position with a wide receiver split each way. And rolling around the left side and the pitch back to Maurer. And Maurer will head it up and will not get back to the 20-yard line. So a loss of a couple of yards on the play.
Yeah, and maybe we could have attacked that edge just a little tighter. Pineview did a good job. Number 55, let me see what his name is right there. Solo Katoa did a nice job of stringing that out. He's a big young man, about 260 pounds, and he just strung that out to the edge. Pineview plays a kind of a 3-3-5 look against us, and so we'll see how we do. Last night we had some success running in the middle.
Second and 12 for the Redmen. Here's Garrett out of the shotgun once again, and the give is to
Tate
this time. Coming from the left side and over the right side, he'll get back to the original line of scrimmage for a pickup of 2 yards, but that's going to bring up third and 10.
You know, and I sense a little bit of, let's see, how do I put this? They're a little tentative tonight along the offensive line, and they're a little tentative in the backfield. And we can't be that way. We've got to hit it hard as it's third and long.
Same formation. Tate to the left, Maurer to the right, and it's Garrett rolling to the right, looking downfield. He's going to have to tuck it away, and he's going to be dropped for a 5-yard loss.
And that'll bring on the punt team. And Derek Ball was trying to get open there, but good coverage, and it was more of a coverage sack than it was a fault of the blocking, as Shem Mackert is going to kick it from his own goal line.
Shem will stand at about his own 1-yard line, maybe with his whole heels on the goal line, and back to receive, standing right on the 50-yard line, is Michael Moten. So it's going to be good field position for Pineview to begin this ball game. 10:13 left to go on your Gem Awards clock. Just underway here at Pineview High School. Here's the snap and the kick by Shem. It's a high spiral kick that's going to be caught, and retreating backwards is the ball carrier Moten. So about a negative 2 yards on the return, but that's still going to be in Cedar territory at about the 49-yard line.
And you'd hear from the stands down there, people are complaining that we were too close and we invaded their halo. In high school football, you only have to give them the opportunity to catch it. There's no designated space there as to how far back you have to be. You only have to give them the opportunity to catch the ball.
They're going to give him forward progress at the Cedar 48, and this is where Pineview will take over. Ryan Javins is the quarterback. He'll swing one out to the left side. It's complete to Moten, and Moten will be knocked out of bounds close to the 45-yard line.
You know, Pineview doing a good job blocking on that edge, on that east sideline there towards the red man. They do a good job of getting on. One of Coach Hosner's strengths is his teaching blocking his wide receivers. One of the things he really does is they hold, and they hold every time, and they just are convinced that the referees won't call it every play, and he's right, they won't.
Fumbled, and the Pineview quarterback Javins is going to have to fall on it, and that's going to be a loss of about 5-6 yards on the play.
And good pressure there by Ryder Berenson, who took the opportunity to knock his tackle back over the top of the quarterback, like that old game where you kneel behind him and someone pushes him over the top. Looked a little bit like that, what he did over the quarterback out there in the middle of the field.
Third and about 14 for the Pineview Panthers, with the ball in Pineview territory now at the 47. The pass across the middle is bobbled and dropped. The intended receiver is number 16, Hudson Reed.
Yeah, Javins has a nice zip on that ball, and he weighed in and got it just at the right time and set it right there in the middle. Three red men defenders right around there. Didn't have a lot of room to catch it, but he definitely could have as it was there, and he just dropped it. Tried to catch it three or four times, dropped at five.
Nick English is going to have to punt it away, standing on his own 31-yard line. And who we got back to receive there, Cleve?
I think that's Maggio.
That must be Luke, right? Yep. Low knuckleball kick is going to hit at the 25, and Luke is going to pick it up at the 7, and he's buried at about the 8-yard line.
You know, and you usually don't want him to catch it right there where he's on the run. And you got the players there, but that ball was going to die, and they were going to get it. You know, he probably saved us 6 yards. Carter Robinson and Kobe Nelson back there blocking on their kill guys, but that's a tough block to make, and those ball players stayed with it. But Luke did a nice job of fielding that so that maybe we weren't going out of the shadow of our own end zone.
They'll spot it on the 7-yard line, first and 10 for the Redmen. Second possession of the game for the Cedar team, 8:39 left to go here, first quarter, on your GEM Awards clock, and your State Bank score still 0-0. State Bank serving Southern Utah since 1957. Garrett with the snap, and it's over his head. It's going to go into the end zone, and Garrett is going to try to get back out, but it's going to be a safety. So Cedar is going to give up 2 points, and they'll have to give up the ball here momentarily from their own 20-yard line.
You know, and that's one of the gambles you take when you're running the shotgun offense. You know, no matter when you're exchanging the ball from the quarterback, the center to the quarterback, that exchange always is a little bit dicey, but it's more so when you're back there at 5 yards and that ball shot over his head and it was deep in the end zone. Garrett did his best to try and get out of there. He maybe could have thrown it out, but then we might have had a lineman downfield. It's worth a shot always when you're in the end zone. The worst thing that can happen is intentional grounding, and it's a safety.
Safety anyway.
Or you get tackled and it's a safety.
Yeah.
Or maybe you get it thrown away and they say, oh, we'll take it back out there. So maybe a little experience there would have helped Garrett out, but we'll see if the Redmen choose to punt it or kick it from their own 20-yard line.
So the Pineview Panthers on the board, 2-0 here with 8:33 left to go in the opening quarter on your GEM Awards clock. GEM Awards is Southern Utah's full-service award store, serving the area for over 50 years. And the first quarter of this ball game is brought to you by Double Tap Ammunition, where every round is hand-inspected for quality. To find out how you can get your hands on the best ammunition around, manufactured right here in Cedar City, go to doubletapammo.com. It's going to be Shem Mackert to punt the ball away at the Cedar 20-yard line. And back to receive, Lance Mandriguez. And Shem gets the signal, and he punts the ball. A high spiral punt is going to be taken by Mandriguez at his own 40-yard line, to the 45, to the 50, across midfield stripe and into Cedar territory to about the 44-yard line. So good field position once again for the Pineview Panthers.
Yeah, good field position, but really good coverage by the Redmen. He only returned it about 8 yards. You're just up against the eight ball there when you're kicking from your own 20-yard line. They're going to get good field position about no matter what you do. See if the Panthers can do more than a three and out and a punt on this possession.
Ryan Javins, the quarterback, junior, 6 foot, 168 pounds, out of the shotgun position with two wide receivers each way. Javin will pitch on the option around the right side, and stepping up in the seam is number 6, Umbungi, and he will get it inside the 40-yard line to about the 37. Nice little pickup on first down there, Cleve.
Yeah, and Parker Haney did a good job trying to get to it, but I felt he was held by Devin Jolly. Lance Mandriguez out there on the edge. That's a tough duty, tough play, but a nice little speed option play there by the Panthers.
So pick up 7 yards, second and three. And here's Javins back to pass. He'll sling it to the left side over the head of his intended receiver. Incomplete. Intended there for number three, Michael Moulton.
And Quade Murray doing a good job of fighting that blocker off and holding and getting in there, maybe putting a little pressure, getting his hands up, making the quarterback throw it just a little bit higher than he wanted to. The Redmen front four of Murray, Berenson, Jordan, and Johnson have been solid all year long.
Trips to the left this time. A single wide receiver out to the right is Carson Clark. And here's Javins back to pass. He slings it across the middle, complete for the first down, and ducking inside the 30-yard line to the 29-yard line is Lance Mandrigas.
Yeah, Jade Bullock was coming off the edge there around the outside on a stunt. Came free, but he ran so far around there he didn't have a chance. And Javins was able to throw it underneath his outstretched arm and complete that pass.
Hey, Bobby's Upholstery, first down for the Panthers, and the ball is on the 29-yard line, first and 10. Here's Javins back in the shotgun position. And Javins giving around the left side to Mpungi, and he will get to about the 25-yard line.
Yeah, and Mpungi just doing a nice job of just bouncing. The old I formation, they used to have that deep I tailback that you kind of gave the ball to, and he just kind of read where the hole was. That's a little bit what they do with this spread offense. The spread's kind of a combination of the old I and the triple option that a lot of teams used to run. A pretty solid offense.
Didn't quite get the 25. It's at the 26. Second and 7. And Mpungi will take it over the right side this time. He's got the edge. 25, 20, 15. Ducks it inside. He's going to go in for the touchdown. Or will they call him out at the 1 yard line?
Nope,
no, they'll say touchdown.
Yeah.
So the Panthers have scored, and it's 8-0.
A moment of hesitation there as all the refs pointed at each other, because one guy has the goal line, but he's got to have the input of his side judge, as the back judge has that the goal line in that situation from 20 yards out. So he had to make sure from the side judge that he hadn't stepped out of bounds. They pointed at each other. The he'll point. The other guy, if he doesn't point back, it's not a touchdown. He goes and marks the spot. If he points back, it's a touchdown.
Nice piece of running there by Mpungi as he stepped inside and then found a seam and turned on the afterburner.
Yeah, and maybe even a better job of blocking out there on the edge by his guys. On the special teams, Pineview's had a tough time getting all of their players on the field. They've always been short one.
Connor Brooksby is in to kick the extra point. It is 8-0, and here comes the kick. Looks good. And it is good. 9-0 Pineview after the safety and the touchdown with extra point. We'll be back in 1 minute with the kickoff.
First quarter, your Panthers 9, Redmond nothing.
At Cedar City Motor Company, our philosophy is simple. Honest, upfront pricing for you and your family. That's why we offer one low price, plain and simple, always. Listed clearly on every new Ford, Lincoln, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, Ram, and every pre-owned vehicle. After all, the price on a vehicle shouldn't depend on your ability to negotiate. Cedar City Motor Company, a new company with a new philosophy.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Ooh, look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920. Did you miss your favorite Backcountry TV program? Don't worry, all of our local Backcountry TV shows can be watched on demand and on your computer, smartphone, tablet, or smart TV. Simply go to www.backcountrytv.net and select the program you want to watch. Backcountry TV, your local sports and entertainment station. Backcountry TV, now on demand.
the end zone. Another touchback.
Another touchback as the kick goes into and out of the end zone, and that will bring it out once again to the 20-yard line where Cedar will take its third possession of the ball game.
And that was another good kick way over Zach Ragsdale's head as the Redmen offensive line of Berenson, Ava, Giles, Murray. Kobe Lotta. For the offensive line for the Redmen.
So once again, it is Braden Garrett, and before the snap of the ball, there is movement on the line of scrimmage, and we'll see what this is.
I think we're going to have a procedure penalty.
It'll
against
be a procedure penalty against Cedar.
Oh no!
Nope. They will mark it offsides against Pine View.
Cedar City's left guard moved, and I thought, you know, just about every time when your guard moves, you're going to get that call on you. But they chose to place the blame on the Panthers.
So 5 yards brings it out to the 25, first and 5 for the Redmen. And here is Garrett. Garrett will give it to Maurer over the left side this time. He'll bang forward and across the 25-yard line to about the 28 he goes.
Yeah, just a nice old-fashioned lead there. Back to each side, one back leads. They hand it to the other one underneath. Just a straight lead. Go man-on-man blocking, and you know, we match up well against the Panthers. We're about the same size all the way across the board. Similar size, similar speed. We'll see what the Redmen have, see if they can answer Pineview's first touchdown.
It'll be 2nd and 2 for the Redmen. Derek Ball split out to the right, and it is Barrick out to the left. Here is the run on the option and heading it upfield and getting it out close to the 29-yard line is Braden Garrett for maybe a yard pickup on the play.
Yeah, I was nervous there at first. He wasn't getting it back to the line of scrimmage. If he had given that ball to Maurer right up the middle, Maurer had a big gain, maybe 12 or 14 yards. Third down and short, a good place to be for the Redmen. Finally getting the ball out of the shadow of their own goalpost.
Gosh, it sure seems kind of quiet tonight. Cleve, maybe a week off is just getting us all out of sync. The crowd seems quiet.
Crowd's quiet, you know. But, you know, this is a good stadium that the Panthers have. Good, solid seating for everybody. Maybe they're just all relaxed in those stadium-type seating chairs.
Here's Garrett giving it to Tate this time. He's out across the 35 to the 38-yard line. And a nice run there by Travis.
Yeah, and Travis, excellent outfielder for the Redmen and a good, solid running back. Been injured a lot of the year. I think that week off may have helped him as much as anybody.
As much as
on
anyone,
the, yeah.
Uh-huh.
That's as good a run as he's made up the middle all year long.
A Bobby's upholstery first down for Cedar. And the ball on the 38-yard line. And Braden Garrett will bring the same formation to the line. Ball out to the right, Barrick to the left. And it's Tate and Maurer to each side. And this time the give is to Maurer, and he will hit the line. A little bit hesitant hitting the line. He'll get it out to the 40-yard line for a pickup of 2.
You know, maybe.
And we've not seen that from Trent. Boy, he has usually hit the hole hard.
Maybe all he could see was his own player's back.
That's right. As
an old offensive lineman, I was always grateful when there was no hole for him to go into and they didn't crash into my back. There's a guy that will remain nameless that played it there that is a pharmacist at Walmart. He used to hit me right on my tailbone about once a game, and I used to want to kill him when we were younger.
I think I know that guy. 2nd and 8 for the Redmen. The ball on the 40-yard line. Man in motion is Barrick, and here is the give around the left side. That's Jade Bullock. And Jade will bring it out to the 45 for a pickup of 5.
Well, maybe the coaches saw Maurer being hesitant, and they said, we know somebody that won't be hesitant.
we'll
no matter what happens.
We'll put a fire under you. And Jade's going to stay in the ball game, and it's going to be Travis Tate go out. So it looks like Bullock and Maurer will be the two running backs this time.
Last night in the JV game when they're in the double overtime, Jade was out there giving the team water as they were doing the coin toss, and he was trying to get all them guys fired up. Jade never lacks for energy, even at 7:50 in the morning in my weights class.
It is 3rd and 3 for the Redmen with the ball right on the Cedar 45-yard line. Man in motion is Barrick, and here is the toss, and hit in the backfield and dropped for a loss is Maurer.
Yeah, and it's going to be 8 yards, and if Bullock doesn't knock it off, there's going to be a flag over there. It's going to be interesting to see who they called on, whether they call that on Bullock or the corner. They were both, I'm sure, exchanging pleasantries over there on the far side.
for a big loss for the Redmen. There is a flag.
Oh, they're going to call defensive holding on the Panthers. That's an interesting call. And Ray gets all the way out on the middle of the field. They have to tell him to get back here on the Pineview sideline.
Personal foul.
Oh, it is personal foul.
Goes against the Panthers. And here comes the mark off, which will give Cedar not only a fresh set of downs, but they'll be in Pineview territory.
For the first time tonight.
Still waiting for the mark off. I think we had it right on the defense, correct?
That's the way they signaled it twice.
And here comes the mark off, and across the 50-yard line, across the 45-yard line, to the 44-yard line of Pineview goes the ball, and it's a first and 10 for the Cedar Redmen. 9-0 Panthers is your State Bank score. 3:40 left to go here first quarter on your Gem Awards clock. So Redmen with a break there. And the ball at the Pineview 44-yard line. Garrett will send ball to the right, Barrick to the left. He's got Tate back in the ball game to his left and Maurer to his right. And here's the snap to Braden Garrett. Braden will give, he'll keep off the right side after faking. And he is driven back after a pickup of about 1 yard. That's 1 yard the hard way, Cleve.
Yeah, it is. And I'd like to tell you that I saw that fake, but I didn't. Excellent fake there by Braden. It'd been sixes either way, whether he'd given it or whether he pulled it on that one. And he, of course, reading the side to that he could run to and not taking into account that outside linebacker stepping up there in the 3-5-3 look that Pineview gives us tonight.
Second and 9 for the Redmen. A ball is split out to the left this time. And here's the snap to Braden Garrett. Braden will give to Maurer over the left side and heading it upfield after a pickup of two. He goes down at the 41-yard line.
You know, one of the hard things about being out of this spread and out of this shotgun is, you know, he makes a great run for 8 yards and he gets 2 yards out of it.
Yeah.
You know, and hard luck as Jade Bullock checks back into that game in a third and long situation. Since no one can hear me down on the sideline, love Jade to death, but they're not throwing him the football on third and long. I guarantee you that.
It is 3rd and 7 for the Redmen. Barrick will split out to the right, ball to the left. And here is the snap to Garrett. Barrick is in motion. And Garrett rolling out to his right, looking downfield. And he's going to fire, and it is intercepted. Intercepted at about the 34-yard line. It's Pineview ball. They'll give him the 35, in fact.
Yeah, and that was Parker Haney trying to get back in there. It was Derek Ball that was trying to get back in there. Parker was a little bit further downfield. And Garrett had no choice but to throw it right there, throw it out of bounds. Maybe he should have thrown it out of bounds and given the Redmen a chance to punt.
It's going to be 1st and 10 for the Panthers on the 35-yard line. Javins, the quarterback, all alone in the backfield as he sends trips to the right, two wide receivers split out to the left. And Javins is back to pass, looking to the right, and it's tipped at the line of scrimmage, incomplete.
Nice job there. Ryder Berenson excited, celebrating a little bit, so that he was obviously the one that hit that. Javins going with a ghost backfield, 3-1 way, 2 the other way. A decent play call, but nice pass rush and getting their arms up just like you teach them in practice.
Two wide receivers split each way, and this time it is Mpungi, the back to the left of the quarterback Javins. Now he'll come over to the right side. The snap to Javins, and he will keep over the right side, but at the snap of the ball, a whistle blows and a flag flies coming in from the umpire.
And I'm thinking Bailey Gray, who was showing his stunt, elicited a twitch out of one of the offensive linemen, and that is indeed how the referee marks that one.
5-yard mark off against the Panthers takes it back to the 30-yard line. Repeat 2nd down. 2nd and 15 for Pineview. And all eyes toward the Pineview sideline as the play signal comes in. It'll be trips to the right. And Javins giving
and a tight end to the left.
Instructions to his quarterback and a tight end lined up to the left. You're correct. And here's Javins with the fake and keeping over the right side. He'll get the line of scrimmage and a pickup of maybe 1 or 2 yards, but that's going to be it. It'll bring up a third and about 13.
And I think that's one of those plays that Coach Esplin had him coached up on, had that really shut down. You know, as you look there on the sideline, either they're signaling in the plays or somebody or two somebodies are having a seizure, by the way. All their gyrations of signaling the plays in.
1:20 left to go here, first quarter. It's 9-0 Pineview on your State Bank scoreboard. And Javins will send three wide receivers out to the right, one split out to the left this time, and Pungi lined up on his left in the running back position. Out of the shotgun, here's the snap, back to pass, and he's going to immediately tuck it away. He gets away from one would-be tackler, several would-be tacklers. Jay Bullock misses him, but finally he's brought down from behind by...
I think that was Bailey Gray on
that's,
that.
Yeah, number 59.
No, that's
Brandon Johnson.
But the Redmen having a great pass rush there. But, you know, the one thing you hate as a defensive coach is the first guy there didn't hang on. The Redmen would have had him for a loss. Still a punting situation, but you would like to have made him punt from 6 yards further back.
It's going to be 4th and 11, and a punting situation in to kick it away is Nick English. Back to receive is Maggio standing on his own 28-yard line. There's the snap and the kick angled toward the near sideline. It's a wobbly kick that's going to hit at about the 40 and bounce to the 35, and that's where it's going to be checked by the Pineview Panthers. 1st and 10 for the Redmen at their own 35, trailing it 9-0 with about 9 seconds left to go here first quarter. Time enough for one play headed in this direction.
And that's one play is all they'll get.
Cedar nosing into Pineview territory once so far in the ball game, but about the 40-yard line is all they could get. Barrick will split out to the right, ball to the left. Maurer and Tate are the running backs to either side of Braden Garrett. And it's Barrick in motion. And the snap over his head once again, and Garrett's going to have to fall on it for a big loss.
15.
All the way back to the 19-yard line.
Oh. And I think Garrett was yelling out signals when he should have been watching for the ball, and he was only half looking at it when it went by his head.
So it'll take it back to the 20. Indeed, a loss of 15 yards, and it's going to bring up a 2nd and 25. That's the end of your quarter. 9-0 Pineview with the first quarter coming to an end. We'll be back in 1 minute.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Hey, Backcountry TV, sell my stuff.
Sell my stuff.
Sell my stuff.
If you have a garage full of stuff you don't need anymore and you want to sell or trade your stuff, we have you covered. Using your camcorder or smartphone, send us a video with the items you want to sell. Don't forget to make a sign with your name, phone number, or email address and price. Then email your video to sellmystuff@backcountrytv.net and we'll broadcast your items for free.
Ooh, look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920.
So we all know that a salesperson's job is to generally do one thing, sell. Here's a thought. At Cedar City Motor Company, our product specialists are paid to help you find the right vehicle, not just the one that makes them the most money. Whether you buy a $3,000 car or a $50,000 truck, our product specialists get paid the same amount. We believe in one low price, plain and simple, always. Find the right vehicle at a price that isn't dependent upon your ability to negotiate. We're a new company with a new philosophy.
We begin the second quarter play with the Panthers leading at 9-0. Cedar with possession of the ball after a 15-yard loss on the snap. that went over the head of Braden Garrett and all the way back to the 20-yard line.
And the Redmen are in a tough position. 25 yards in three downs is a long ways to go.
Second and 25 for the Redmen.
No turnovers. Well, there was an interception in the ball game so far, wasn't there? And you almost count a safety as worse than a turnover, because not only you give up points, but you got to give the ball away as well.
Yep.
Here is Garrett back to pass, looking, now rolling over to his left. He'll fire. It is caught. Note now dropped by Maurer. And that's going to be incomplete. It'll be third and 25.
Yeah, and the Redmen trying to set up the screen. I didn't like the way the Redmen receivers ran on this side. They didn't sell it to the linebackers and safeties who were looking out of their periphery of their vision. And Maurer just couldn't quite get open. And Garrett stopped, looked back. Then he had to kind of run around. And then he barely kind of just flung it around there. And Maurer couldn't quite catch that. And luckily for the Redmen, that they called that incomplete, or that would have been a touchdown the other way as the Panthers picked up that what they thought was a fumble.
Barrick will split out to the right. Derek Ball to the left. And the ball on the 20-yard line, third and 25 for the Redmen. And here is the keeper over the right side, hit right at the line of scrimmage and driven back is Braden Garrett. The stop there made by number 90, Brooks Miley.
And there was nobody fooled on that one as the Redmen send on their punt team again.
It's going to be Michael Moten back to receive, standing right on the 50-yard line. And Shem Mackert to punt the ball away for Cedar. He'll stand on his own five.
And they have number 90 listed as a freshman.
He's got some good size to him.
6'2", 236 as a freshman. Wow.
Pineview with great field position, it seems, on every possession. And Cedar just the opposite. Here's the kick. A nice spiral kick is going to be caught at the 47-yard line. Now breaking back to the inside is the ball carried to the 45, to the 40-yard line, to the 39-yard line of Cedar. They'll give him the 38, in fact. A nice return there.
And you're hoping, you know, anything helps out at this point in time. If we'd have hit him when we tackled him the first time, that would have been nine less yards for them, and it would have put them close to the 50-yard line. But now they're inside the 40, and that's not a long ways to go for a touchdown.
Number 19 is Dallin Brown, the ball carrier, or kick receiver, I should say. It'll be first and 10 for the Panthers on the Cedar 38-yard line. Great field position here for the Pineview team. And it's a pistol formation for Pineview, and wide receivers split each way. Javins will give to Mpungi. He is back to the line of scrimmage, but not much of a pickup, maybe a half yard.
Yeah, and out of the pistol there, they're just running a midline look where they run the dive just right over the center's right cheek, and the Redmen stopped him for less than 1 yard.
We'll call it a pickup of one, first and nine. Same formation for the Panthers as far as the backfield is concerned, but this time they'll send two wide receivers split out to the right. Mpungi keeping off the right side this time, inside the 35-yard line to the 33 for a pickup of four more.
And they must have seen something they liked on that right side as they came out and run nearly the same play, but they ran it instead of running it through the A gap, they ran it through the B gap that time.
Third and five for the Panthers. And the same formation, two wide receivers split out to the right. And here's Javins out of the shotgun. Actually, no longer the pistol. Running up to the right is Mpungi. And it's caught at the 20 and thrown down immediately. But picking up the first down is the receiver, number 7, Dylan Hendrickson. So that'll move the sticks. Another Bobby's Upholstery first down. Bobby's Upholstery, new owners, same great people, turning out quality upholstery work for your ATVs, cars, trucks, home furniture, 454 North Main Street in Cedar City.
Ryan Davis still at the helm for the Panthers.
First and 10 for the Panthers. Javins once again out of the pistol. And flags fly and whistles blow before the snap of the ball. It's going to be a false start on the Panthers.
And a break goes the Redmen way. The Redmen, it seems to, when they show blitz right there, that right guard wiggles a little bit, makes him a little bit nervous. I don't know if he doesn't know exactly who he's supposed to get, or he's nervous he won't get the help that he needs. But it's been pretty beneficial for the Redmen when they've shown the blitz.
The ball was at the 21. Now it's back at the 26. First and 15 for the Panthers. Second quarter underway. 9:15 remains on your Gem Awards clock, and it's still 9-0 Panthers. A safety and a touchdown. And here is the keeper by Javins over the right side. He'll duck up into a seam and pick up about 3 yards on the carry, maybe four.
Almost getting back to the original line of scrimmage there. They dove off the right-hand side. Parker Haney had quarterback. He didn't tackle him, but he turned him back into where his buddies were to help him out. As the Panthers do kind of a line shift and send in about five more guys.
Tough spot there for the Panthers. And it's going to be second and 12 with the ball on the 23. Javins with the snap, and he's back to pass, fires to the left side. It's caught, but immediately going to the ground is Lance Mandriguez.
Yeah, and Mandriguez just finding where the hole in the zone where the Redmen were actually in man. But sometimes when you settle in there early, you don't have anybody on you. You have a guy back because you have to stagger your defense because you can't play all your defense at the same level. Or when they do crossing routes, you'll run right into each other and you'll actually pick each other instead of having the offense have to pick you.
5 yard pickup, that takes the ball to the 18 yard line. Third and 7 for the Panthers. One wide receiver split each way and a man in motion slowly to the middle of the field. Javins back to pass, fires it across the middle, incomplete, intended there for Nick English.
Yeah, and I think Nick's their go-to guy when they want to get that ball for a first down. They bring him in, and now the Panthers bring their field goal unit onto the field.
Number 14 will try, Connor Brooksby, a sophomore, 6 foot one, 175 pounds. 9-0 is your score. The Panthers out in front, and Brooksby trying to make it 12-0 with a kick of about 35 yards. Holding is going to be Ryan Javins, the quarterback. And the left footer will line it up almost to the left hash. There's the snap. The kick is up. It looks good, and it is good. And 12-0 is your State Bank score. Panthers out in front. We'll be back in 1 minute with the kickoff.
Backcountry TV brings you the hard-hitting action of high school sports. Join us for all the play-by-play action as we spotlight our student athletes on the gridiron. Backcountry TV and Cherry Creek Radio cover all the live action on game night with playback of all the action every Tuesday and Wednesday at 7 p.m. Watch the Cedar Redmond play on Tuesday at 7 with the action of the Canyon View Falcons on Wednesday at 7. Home or away, Backcountry TV will bring you the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. Redmond Falcons on Backcountry TV.
Ooh, look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920.
At Cedar City Motor Company, our philosophy is simple, honest, upfront pricing for you and your family. That's why we offer one low price, plain and simple, always. Listed clearly on every new Ford, Lincoln, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, Ram, and every pre-owned vehicle. After all, the price on a vehicle shouldn't depend on your ability to negotiate. Cedar City Motor Company, a new company with a new philosophy.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
All right, 12-0 is the State Bank score. 7:43 left to go on the Gem Awards clock, and Pineview to kick the ball away. For the third time in this ball game, they've got a safety, a touchdown, and a field goal of 35 yards. That's where 12 points come from. And back to receive. It's going to be Rags. Is that caught actually in the end zone there.
And Maggio and Ragsdale traded sides. Maggio was thinking maybe they won't kick it over my head, but they didn't kick it over his head. They just kicked it 2 yards deep in the end zone, and he wisely just.
So for the third time in the ball game, the kick goes into the end zone, comes out to the 20-yard line, and Cedar looking to make something happen here on this possession. 7:43 left to go, and they trail it 12-0.
And the only time they've got into Panther territory was with the aid of a personal foul.
Here is Garrett with just one running back, and he'll give the ball to Maurer across the 25-yard line. Out to about the 28 is Maurer. Nice little run there. And that's how you hit the hole, Cleet.
Yeah, his tentativeness has kind of gone away on that one. Maybe he saw a hole and he went a little bit harder right there. And 7 yards for the red man. Kind of a poor spot by the down box over there.
Yeah.
But the red men need to get something going here before this gets away with them with 7 minutes left in the first half.
Second quarter is brought to you by Ron's Sporting Goods, Southern Utah's choice for motorcycles, ATV, service parts, accessories. Ron's been in business for over 50 years at the same location, 138 South Main. Here is Garrett giving to Maurer over the left side this time. Another hole across the 30-yard line out to the 35. He's got the Bobby's Upholstery first down.
Yeah, and the red men using a more of a power formation there as they went to double tight, bringing, I believe, Mackert into the game to play on the opposite side of where Parker Haney was. And then they use Tate and Ball as the slot backs.
First and 10 on the 35-yard line for Cedar. It'll be Travis Tate splitting out on the left side. Derek Ball is split out on the right. And Maurer is the lone setback to the side of Garrett. Tate in motion. And the give on the jet to Tate. He's got the 35. He'll head it upfield to the 39. Pick up of 4 yards on the play.
And a long 4 yards.
And a long 4 yards, most of it east and west.
Yeah, ran about 40 yards for 4 yards on that one as the red men have the ball spotted on the near hash closest to us so we can get a little better idea of what's going on in the ball game.
Second and 6 for the red men with the ball at the 39-yard line. 12-0 Panthers is your State Bank score. In a game that has playoff implications, we'll talk a little bit more about playoffs. We did see that Juan Diego leads Canyon View 7-6. And here is Garrett with the fake and keeping it over the left side, finds a seam out to the 45-yard line, close to the 50 he goes. They'll bring the ball all the way out to, they're going to mark him at the 49-yard line, Cleve. Nice run there by Garrett.
Excellent run by Garrett. Garrett's shifty, he's fast, he can put his head down and take a licking if he needs to, but he's able to just kind of slide his way in between there and almost get into Panther territory. Like I said earlier, the Redmen really need this drive.
Another Bobby's Upholstery first down for the Redmen. And Tate will split out to the left once again. It's going to be Jade Bullock, the running back, to the left of Garrett. Derek Ball split out to the right. And the give is to Bullock. He'll hit the line and surge into Panther territory to the 48-yard line of Pineview.
Yeah, not quite 4 yard gain on that, as the referee will creep his way back and will give it, make it 3 as Jade leaves the field and Maurer comes back on.
Pick up a 3 yard.
So Bullock picks up 3, and he's got the ball in Panther territory at the 48, 2nd and 7. 5.5 minutes remain here in the second quarter of play. 12-0 Panthers is your State Bank score. Tate will split out to the right, and a timeout is going to be called by Cedar. Timeout brought to you by Cedar City Chamber of Commerce. Maybe it's time for you to check out what all the benefits of being a member of the Chamber of Commerce. Visit cedarcitychamber.org. We'll be back in 1 minute.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Ooh, look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent.
Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920.
Second and seven for the Redmen with the ball at the Pineview 48-yard line after the timeout. It is Tate split out to the left, ball to the right. And Trent Maurer. And here is the give to Maurer over the left side. He's going to be hit short of the line of scrimmage. In fact, he's going to lose 3 yards, and back in Cedar territory we go. I almost thought on that motion that Travis Tate headed upfield a little too soon. I think Cedar caught a break there.
I was in total agreement with you there. And that Dallin Peterson for the Panthers, I believe that was his name, Austin Peterson. There's Dallin Brown above him, Austin Peterson there. But he put a licking on Maurer. Maybe we'll see Maurer be a little tentative again.
Back to the 49-yard line of Cedar we go, and it's a third and 10. It's the original line of scrimmage. Maurer lined up to the left of Garrett now, and it's Derek Ball split to the right, Travis Tate to the left. Ball is in motion, and it's Garrett rolling out to the right, looking downfield, fires it, and it's caught. It's intercepted, but a penalty flag comes in. It's going to be pass interference. So the ball is intercepted by number 22, D'Angelo Mpungi, but it's
all for naught.
All for naught. It's going to be Cedar with a first down on the pass interference.
Yeah, and that'll bring it almost at about the 36-yard line.
Shem Mackert was the intended receiver, and he was hit way early.
Yep, about 3 yards before the ball got there. That's a pretty easy call. Glad the referees agreed with us.
So the penalty flag is laying on the 36-yard line. Not that the spot necessarily is important in this case.
Oh, they're going to be offsetting penalties, as they call
it. We've got a hold against Cedar as well, so it's going to be an offsetting penalty.
So
it will not
third.
Be a first down. It'll be repeat third down all the way back to the 49-yard line we go again. And now I see the penalty flag back in the backfield.
Yeah,
I didn't see it originally.
No, neither did I. It's not very easy to see. It was laying right there in the middle of the P. But there were players all over there impeding our field of vision on that one.
So third down repeated. And it's going to be third and 10. So a break of sorts for the Redmen.
Could have been worse. We could have had holding or the interception. So we'll take it, I suppose.
Tate split to the left once again. Ball to the right. And a double tight end situation as well. And here comes the keeper right up the middle by Braden Garrett after faking the jet. And I wasn't the only one faked out on that one. Is inside the 40-yard line, he goes. He's got the first down.
Yeah, and it looked as though none of the middle defenders there for the Panthers believed he had the ball, and they just kind of let him run right through him. Didn't even stick an arm out to slow him down. And Garrett, as much as anything, tripped on his own feet. He was expecting contact, and he had his body lean maybe a little too far in front of him.
11-yard pickup for Braden Garrett gives Cedar the Bobby's Upholstery first down. It's Garrett in the backfield with Bullock. And here is the give to Bullock over the left side. He'll turn it upfield, and he'll pick up about 2 yards on the play, 38-yard line.
Yeah, Jade running really hard there to get to the edge. He put his left foot in the ground and slipped just a little bit on this turf. It's a little different than our grass. It's a little smoother this time of year. Natural grass gets kind of lumpy and hard late in the fall as you don't water it as much. And so a little different footing than what maybe the Redmen are used to practicing on at home.
Second and 8 for the Redmen at the Pineview 38-yard line. 3.5 minutes remain here, second quarter. It's 12-0 Pineview. And here's Braden Garrett sending Derek Ball in motion. And Garrett will keep over the right side, looking for a seam inside the 35 to the 33, and then bent backwards by number 36. Jacoby Clausen.
And Garrett doing a nice job of just faking that jet both ways and then just going as hard as he can right up the middle. Brings up third and short for the Redmen. And we've got a referee's timeout as he is trying to decide something, and I'm not sure what he's trying to decide there.
We'll take the timeout as well, brought to you by Cedar City Chamber of Commerce. Back in 1 minute.
At Cedar City Motor Company, our philosophy is simple, honest, upfront pricing for you and your family. That's why we offer one low price, plain and simple, always. listed clearly on every new Ford, Lincoln, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, Ram, and every pre-owned vehicle. After all, the price on a vehicle shouldn't depend on your ability to negotiate. Cedar City Motor Company, a new company with a new philosophy.
Southern Utah businesses, you can reach thousands of potential clients while supporting high school sports. Students and parents love to watch and cheer on the local teams. Call Brian at 435-590-3056 at Backcountry TV for your high school sports. DVDs of Cedar High and Canyon View football games are now available for just $20. Share your memories of high school sports with family and friends by ordering your copy today. Call 435-625-1217 to order. That's 435-625-1217.
Third and three for the Panthers. The give to Maurer over the right side. Maurer will pick up a yard on the play, but it's still going to be short of the first down. Fourth and about two.
Yeah, that timeout was eventually charged to the red man as the referee signaled his time and then walked to the sideline to talk to the red man. Then the red man took a timeout and the referee never signaled that. And that's why we didn't inform you of whose timeout that was.
2 minutes left to go and counting. Here's Garrett on a fourth and two situation for the red man. And Garrett will keep it over the left side. He'll be close, but it's going to depend on the mark. Looks like they're going to mark him short.
Yeah, they're going to mark him short about a foot as it brings up Panther ball. First down going the other way. Minute 43 left in the first half. 12-0 your score. The Redmen had a drive there and then just couldn't garner that next first down and turn the ball back over to the Panthers.
Panthers come up with the stop on a fourth and two, and they allow one, but take over the ball on downs. And it's going to be Javins back into the ball game with the Pine View offense. Two wide receivers split out to the left, two to the right. And here's Javins back to pass on first down, slings it to the left side. It's caught there, and a penalty flag comes in. That's interference, but it's caught anyway. Across the 50-yard line to the 45 to the 41-yard line. Out of bounds at the 40, they're going to say. So a nice pickup there by the Pine View Panthers.
And Maurer guilty of that pass interference as he put his arm, actually grabbed onto the shoulder pads of the guy and slung himself over the front, went long arm over. Pass interference, missed the ball, missed the tackle. Nothing good on that play.
Gave up about 20 yards on the gain.
Yeah, and only took, 14 seconds off the clock on that one.
So it's going to be Pine View ball in Cedar territory at the 40-yard line, first and 10 for the Panthers.
And the Panthers no doubt are going to try to put another score up on the Redmen.
1:34 left to go here in the half. Pine View leading 12-0. Here's Javins out of the shotgun. Two wide receivers split each way. Javins straight back to pass under a rush. He'll step up in the pocket, and he's going to be down there by our buddy
Quade
number 55.
Murray. Quade Murray, and then the Panthers making use of one of their timeouts, bringing up second and about 13 for the Panthers as a host of Panther coaches go out there. Back in the old days, when I first started playing football in high school, only the quarterback could go to the sideline on a timeout. And then they made it so only the coach could come to the middle of the field. And then they made it so the team could come to the edge. And the one coach could go out there. The other coaches can yell from the sideline. Now, as long as they come to the make yourself ready for play mark, the whole coaching staff apparently can come out there now. Most coaches don't have that many come out, but I believe there are five Panther coaches out there. Maybe a few too many Chiefs for the number of Indians that are on the field.
It's going to be a second and 13 for Pine View with 1:24 left to go in the half. The clock stopped, of course, on the timeout. And Pine View looking to put some more points on the board before intermission, and the Panthers will receive to start the second half, having won the toss and deferred. Carson Clark is the wide receiver split out to the right, as is Michael Moten. It's number 7, Nick English, split out to the left. The running back, Mpungi, to the left of the quarterback, Javins. And here's the snap. Javins back to pass, stepping up in the pocket once again, fires across the middle, incomplete, intended for number seven, Nick English.
Yeah, and Nick English, I'm not sure if those pads would be certified. They're a little small on him.
Penalty flag on the far side of the field. Holding against the Panthers is the call. The spot of the foul is the 47-yard line of Cedar. And it should be a 10-yard mark off from there.
So that'll bring up about 25 yards for a first down. But with a minute 19 left in the half, they're going for an end zone score. And you just as well throw it from 65 yards out as, well, I guess it'd be 55 yards out as from 45, right?
Yep, here comes the mark off. The ball is marked at the near hash, although that penalty flag came in from the far side. And it's all the way back to the 43-yard line of Pineview. And that brings up a second and a bunch, about 23, 24 yards to go. Actually, 27 yards. Javins, the quarterback, here's the snap, back to pass, stepping up once again, eluding a tackler. He's to the 45-50, still on his feet to the 47 six-yard line. And so he picked up about 12 or 13 yards on the scramble. Still plenty of yards to go for the first down.
And Bailey Gray on that blitz off the edge and maybe getting a little too excited. If he had slowed down just a little bit and maybe come to balance, as Virgil used to say, he could have probably made that tackle in the backfield.
Here's Javins with the swing pass out to the right side to Mpungi. He's got it. He got the edge inside the 40 to the 35, knocked out of bounds inside the 35-yard line. No, they're going to say he stepped out at the 36. That's still going to bring up a fourth down and about 6 yards to go for the first down.
And maybe more importantly, as we have 44.4 seconds left in the second quarter.
So we'll see what happens here. Out of field goal range. And looking to pick up first down yardage with 44 seconds remaining in the half and leading it 12 to nothing are the Panthers. Two wide receivers each way once again. Here's Javins back to pass, slings it to the left side and incomplete as his intended receiver slipped and fell to the ground. That is number eight, Jacob Brand.
Yep.
And so the ball goes over on downs to Cedar, and now Cedar has an opportunity to put some points on the board before the half. 40.8 seconds remain.
And it's going to be a long ways to go unless Mazio has a heck of a return. He probably ought to go.
Because the ball was turned over on downs. It was fourth down.
That's correct.
And so it'll be Cedar ball at the 36-yard line.
Luke was so confused.
Luke was ready to receive the punt.
He confused me.
See, it's first and 10 for the Redmen at their own 36. Ball to the right. Tate out to the left, it looks like. And the running back is Trent Maurer. Here's the snap to Braden Garrett, rolling out to his right. Pumps once, looking downfield. And he fires it to ball, and it's going to be intercepted. Intercepted at the 34, running up the sideline to about the 47-yard line. Right around midfield is when the Panthers will get another shot with 30.1 seconds left to go. Not really an advisable pass there, Cleveland,
no,
and triple coverage.
And that's one of the things that you worry about is turning the ball over and continue to give them opportunities to score. The Panthers have had the ball so much. The Redmen are subbing in a few guys. We have Peacock that's in at the defensive end. We have Nate Ellis in at the one defensive tackle, along with Daniel Jordan and Johnson.
First and 10 for the Panthers. They'll mark it right at the 50-yard line. Here's Javins back to pass, fires it up the middle, caught at the 20-yard line. What a catch there by Lance Mandriguez.
And sometimes you need to just be smart as a coach and run the clock out and get back in and maybe retreat a little bit and save yourself to fight another day. And it might come back to hurt the Redmen that the Redmen decided to try and throw that ball.
Once again, the Pineview Panthers set to receive the kickoff. Looks like a timeout called. We'll take it as well. We'll be back in 1 minute. Brought to you by Cedar City Chamber.
So we all know that a salesperson's job is to generally do one thing, sell. Here's a thought. At Cedar City Motor Company, our product specialists are paid to help you find the right vehicle, not just the one that makes them the most money. Whether you buy a $3,000 car or a $50,000 truck, our product specialists get paid the same amount. We believe in one low price, plain and simple, always. Find the right vehicle at a price that isn't dependent upon your ability to negotiate. We're a new company with a new philosophy.
Hey, Backcountry TV, sell my stuff.
Sell my stuff.
Sell my stuff.
If you have a garage full of stuff you don't need anymore and you want to sell or trade your stuff, we have you covered. Using your camcorder or smartphone, send us a video with the items you want to sell. Don't forget to make a sign with your name, phone number, or email address and price. Then email your video to sellmystuff@backcountrytv.net and we'll broadcast your items for free.
Javon's pass is complete to Jacob Mpungi, and he will take the ball close to the 10-yard line. That will give the Panthers a first down. It'll be first and goal at the 10.
And he did a good job of getting to the edge and then getting out of bounds, giving the Flyers a chance with 16.7 seconds. They really have realistically two, maybe three cracks at the end zone right here.
16.7 seconds remain in the half, first and goal, with the nose of the ball just inside the 10-yard line. Here's Javins out of the shotgun. And he's back to pass, looking to his left, rolling to his left. Now he's off to the right. Penalty flag comes in, and Javins is out of bounds, but that's going to be a holding penalty, I believe, Cleve.
Absolutely. Where that's thrown, that's one of the ones that's really easy for us, is when that umpire just kind of flips that flag out of his pocket.
Everybody. And especially careful to place it at a certain spot as he picks up the flag and places it right on the 15-yard line, so you know it's going to be old.
Yeah, he threw it where he thought it was. He didn't quite get it there. And there's a hold on the Panthers. Last night we had a block in the back on Panthers, and the referee on our side threw the flag on their sideline. He had to be 50 yards away. It's a pretty blatant call, but I've never seen a flag fly so far. It didn't go the whole 50 yards at the angle across the field, but it about went 35. It was pretty good arm by the referee.
Repeat first down. Downs really aren't the issue here, as there's 9.6 seconds remaining in the half. But more importantly, the ball is spotted on the 25-yard line now, and the Panthers with a little more to have to gain. Here's Javins back to pass, and he is going to be dropped in the backfield, and that is going to be the end of the half, Cleve.
Yep, and number 10, Bailey Gray on that. And I think we have a timeout by the Panthers.
So they may have got the timeout before clock expired. I'm seeing 0 seconds up on the clock, but they'll probably
replace
that.
They're saying 1 second. They're holding up 1 second.
1 second.
They're pointing up here in the booth. And everybody, we've got 1 second and one play. See if the Redmen go down just 12-0.
We'll keep the timeout right here. In fact, Cleve, let's go ahead with the halftime smile report brought to you by Dr. Ryan Gunn and All About Smiles Dentistry. A beautiful, healthy smile for life starts with the right dentist, Dr. Gunn, and All About Smiles Dentistry provides the most comfortable, current, and affordable dental care possible at 409 South Main Street in Cedar City. Adjustments at halftime, Cedar sputtering.
Absolutely. Have not to this point been able to mount any significant drive. They've been helped out by some penalties, but they've done a nice job of not giving up too many big plays, the Panthers, but the Redmen need to definitely get the ball, march it down the field, shorten this game down, score some touchdowns. 12-point lead is not insurmountable at this point in the game, as we're going to try about a 48-yard field goal.
Okay, 48-yard field goal with 1 second remaining. Into the ball game is Connor Brooksby. He's got a good leg on him.
He does. We'll see if he has the accuracy.
See if he has this much.
I think the accuracy at this point is going to be a bigger deal than the length.
There's the snap. The hold is down. The kick is up. It's low and tipped, and it's no good. And that will be the end of the half. 12-0. Pineview leads it after a safety, a touchdown with extra point, and a field goal here at halftime. And we'll take the two-minute break and be back with more right after this.
Ooh, look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
At Cedar City Motor Company, our philosophy is simple, honest, upfront pricing for you and your family. That's why we offer one low price, plain and simple, always. Listed clearly on every new Ford, Lincoln, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, Ram, and every pre-owned vehicle. After all, the price on a vehicle shouldn't depend on your ability to negotiate. Cedar City Motor Company, a new company with a new philosophy.
Southern Utah businesses, you can reach thousands of potential clients while supporting high school sports. Students and parents love to watch and cheer on the local teams. Call Brian at 435-590-3056 at Backcountry TV for your high school sports. DVDs of Cedar High and Canyon View football games are now available for just $20. Share your memories of high school sports with family and friends by ordering your copy today. Call 435-625-1217 to order. That's 435-625-1217.
But it's just kind of interesting how, you know, it's only about a 40-minute drive from my house to here.
Yeah.
And it's a world different.
Yeah, they say about 3 degrees for every 1,000 feet in elevation. I think it is.
I would believe that. Right there where the Redmond water tank is, that is about 5,995 feet.
Uh-huh.
So about 6,000 down to about, I think it's probably about 24 or 25 right here.
Yeah, 23 right in the middle of the town near the temple, huh?
Yeah, so probably about 24 or 24 and a half right here.
Here comes the kick. It's a low squib kick that's going to be taken at the 22-yard line, brought out to the 25, 30. And 35-yard line, out to the 40, 45, and out of bounds, close to the 45-yard line. Nice return there.
Yeah, nice return. Coach Espin always says, why can't we just line up and kick it out of bounds at the 34-yard line, give them the ball at the 35, then we always know what we're going to have, and I don't have that anxiety of trying to decide as the Panthers almost bring it back into Redmond territory, and they'll mark the ball right at the 45-yard line.
First and 10 for the Panthers, who lead it 12-0, second half just underway here. In this game, which has playoff implications, as we described at halftime. Third and fourth spots stay at home. The fifth and sixth spots have to travel on the road. Here's the swing pass out to the left side, complete to Moten, and he'll be knocked out of bounds close to midfield.
Yeah, and then they used Mpunge for kind of a decoy there and ran him out wide and then used him as a blocker on Maggio, and Maurer had to come from that outside linebacker invert position to make that tackle. Excellent setup play by the Panthers.
They're going to say he went out of bounds at the 48-yard line, so it's a pickup of 3 yards, second and seven. And here is Javins to pass. He swings it over to the right side this time, complete to the 50, 45, 40. Inside the 40 to the 37, 36-yard line. And a big, big pickup there as they swing it over to the wide side of the field.
Yeah, just working the edges there and trying to outrun you. And obviously just a little bit quicker. But it's always easier to run when you have the ball and you're trying to run away from somebody than rather trying to catch them.
Moten to the left for three, and then he heads out to the right side for the big pickup. A fresh set of downs for the Panthers. First and 10 with the ball at the 37-yard line of Cedar. Javins will give right up the middle and immediately dropped, and not even getting back to the line of scrimmage is Jacob Mpungi.
Yeah, it looks like they're going to compromise there. One had it 1 yard long, one had it 1 yard short, so they're just going to mark it back at the
right back at the original line of scrimmage. So second and 10 for the Panthers as all eyes are toward the Panther sideline for the signals. coming back into the ball game for a Zions Bank substitution is number 3, Michael Moten. Brought to you by Zions Bank. There is no substitute for having the right banking partner. Zions Bank, we haven't forgotten who keeps us in business. And Javins, the quarterback, will swing it to the left side this time. And Boongie has it, and he's going to be dropped. Nice tackle there in the open field.
Yeah, Quade Murray did a good job getting the job done. And luckily, he got a hold of the jersey, not the shoulder pads. Or they would have definitely dinged us on that one.
Loss of 4 yards on the play takes it back to the 42-yard line. That's actually about a five-yard loss, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Nearly five.
Nice play there by Quade. Interesting, the linemen don't even look at the sideline, only the backs do. And then the quarterback yells something else at him. Out at him, and they all know what to do.
Two to the left, two to the right for Javins. And here comes the snap, looking to pass right away, swings it to the left side, complete. And it's to the 35-yard line for a pickup of 7 yards or so. That'll take it past the original line of scrimmage for a fourth down and about 8 yards to go for the first down.
Interesting play call there, as they didn't even try to get it close to the line of scrimmage, for the first down. I think they were just trying to get Maggio to maybe bite on that, and the Redmen don't have anyone back to receive the punt. Now Maggio goes back, and Barrett comes over to block.
Kanoa Lung Choi is into punt for the first time in this ball game. There's the kick. It's an end-over-end kick that's going to hit and check back toward the line of scrimmage at about the 15-yard line.
It definitely took a little short Redman bounce as it hit and it bit and it came back. It's always interesting to see those little black beads. They are everywhere on you when you even just coach on this field. I've never played on turf, obviously, because it's way, way, way after my time. But they are everywhere when you coach. I can't even imagine how bad they're in your shoes and everywhere else when you play on them.
They'll mark the ball at the 16-yard line, first and 10 for the Cedar Redmen, as Trent Maurer comes out of the ball game.
And wisely getting out of the game before the huddle breaks, so they're not called with a participation penalty.
Travis Tate is the running back to the right of Garrett. And the give is to Tate, trying to find the edge. He's not going to get it. He's going to lose 3 yards on the play.
At least three, maybe four by the mark. But he never did get going north and south and was only running sideways, and the defensive end just kept pushing our tackle upfield and made the tackle in the backfield.
Second and 13 for the Redmen, headed in the wrong direction here. They trail it 12 to nothing, and just under 9 minutes remain here in the third quarter play. The third quarter is brought to you by Grifols. As a Grifols plasma donor, your comfort and safety are the number one priority. After all, it's your donations that make our life-changing medications possible. Visit grifolsplasma.com or drop by the Cedar City location in the Providence Center. The snap, and Garrett with the keeper, and he will be lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage there. It's going to be third and 13.
Yeah, and faking the jet there to ball. If you watched any film on this, they gave the jet to ball once last week or 2 weeks ago. Not really a great fake. Much better fake coming back the other way with Beck or with Tate. The Redmen have a third and long right here. They've done what we said they need to do. They held the Panthers, got the ball back. We haven't done a very good job of moving the chains so far. Third down and long, opportunity for the Redmen.
Ball will split to the right, Barrick to the left. And the running back is Travis Tate. And the give will be to Barrick on the jet. He wiggles away from one tackler. He's across the 20-yard line to about the 22, and that'll still be about 5 yards short of the first down, fourth down.
Yeah, about a 9-yard gain for him. And when you start on the far, far, far sideline and come all the way, he ran a long way, so he'll be a little bit winded when he runs off the edge of the field for the Redmen as they bring their punt team on. And Mackert will punt from about his own 6-yard line.
Settling back to receive on the 50-yard line is Michael Moten. Panthers lead it 12-0. 7:20 left to go third quarter on your Gem Awards clock. And here comes the kick. And it's an end-over-end kick that's going to hit and kick. And it's going to be picked up at the 42-yard line. Out across the 50 to the 45, knocked out of bounds. Close to the 40-yard line is the ball carrier.
And I think we don't have a flag here, but we do have a Redmen player down on the field.
Shen Mackert.
He is not comfortable at this time.
So Shem went down. Didn't see if there was contact there, Cleve, after the punt.
I was too busy watching his good punt to see what happened there. But I think you're obviously some kind of contact, but there's no flag down there. So who knows what kind of contact it was, because there's not a penalty. I always am interested in why teams nail, because we get here in the late season. You go up to University of Utah, it's going to be 38, 40 degrees. You're playing a hard ball game like this, you kneel out on the field, you're going to cramp, you're going to be the next guy off. I know that the people say it's sportsmanship. I don't know if it's sportsmanship or an unwise decision that has come to us from soccer. As Mackert's still down on the field, and I think, Chris, if you have a timeout loaded up, we might want to take one right here.
Yeah, let's go ahead and give you the field conditions for tonight, brought to you
the referees are moving the ball, so
okay.
So there must be some sort
there
of penalty.
There was a flag. Well,
there it
now
is.
He's sticking it in his pocket.
Now he's going to show it to us. It's going to be roughing the kicker, and that's an automatic first down. So Mackert laid down on the flag out there. That's why we couldn't see it. The ref had to dig it out from underneath him.
Weather and field conditions tonight brought to you by Community Auto Center. It's always clear sailing when you go with Community Auto Center, with great selection and quick financing at the corner of Westview Drive and Highway 56. Right now in St. George, 70 degrees, so not bad. But Shem with a lot of help to get off the field.
Shem had the wheels. We hope you're okay, young man.
And once again, the weather conditions, no wind. And 70 degrees here. Kind of a pleasant night to play football.
Really a nice night. Kind of a fall night that would be indicative of early September up in Cedar. Really, really a nice night.
The ball is spotted at the 36-yard line. And Cedar will have the ball first and 10 there after the penalty flag. Now, Shem must have fallen down on the penalty flag.
Yeah, he was laying right
on
it.
He was laying on it.
Well, the ref went and picked it up from underneath him.
From underneath him.
And as the only indication we had is they didn't mark the ball where he was tackled. The referee started marching back and marking it off. He didn't even signal and indicate it until after everything was all said and done.
Shem being helped all the way off the field and even over on the far sideline now. And it's going to be first and 10 for Cedar with the ball at the 36. Here is Garrett keeping, and a nice open field tackle there made by number 20, Austin Peterson, for a loss of 2 yards on the play.
Yeah, Peterson doing a good job. He attacked him there. He didn't look at Garrett's wiggle at all, and he just went right down through his thighs, just exactly how you want to tackle in the open field as Maurer runs off the field.
Garrett falls forward, so it's a net loss of just a yard on the play. Second and 11 for Cedar. Barrick will split to the right, and on the boundary side, it's going to be Travis Tate in the slot, and Derek Ball split out to the right. And here's the give to Jade Bullock. He's trying to find the edge as well, and he won't get it. A loss of another 2 yards.
Yeah, and one of the things, not only is Mackert our punter, but he's our other tight end that we've been using in that double tight formation. As now I think we're going to see Sean Peacock come into the game and run that double tight, as he is the third tight end. He's on, he's off, he's back off again, as they keep changing their mind on whether Peacock's going to come in and play that defensive end, or excuse me, that tight end for the first time this season.
Third and 13 for the Redmen. They've lost a yard on first down, 2 yards on second down. And Cedar just trying to get their feet under him in this ball game. Man in motion is Barrick, and keeping right up the middle is Braden Garrett. He's out across to the 40-yard line. They'll give him the 39-yard line is where they're going to spot him, it looks like.
Yeah, he kind of bounced to the 40-yard line. As that brings up fourth down again, it's going to be interesting to see who the Redmen bring on the punter. I think that's going to
be
Trent Maurer.
Trent Maurer to punt it away, it looks like. As,
and that's a good choice.
Mackert was injured.
Because I won't say who the JV punter is, but he's not very good, as he kicked one exactly sideways last night for a net loss of 12 yards.
Trent standing on his own 25-yard line, set to punt the ball away. Fourth and about 7 for the Redmen. And it's a low snap, but Trent will punt it, and he got a good leg into it. It's going to go all the way back to the 25-yard line where it's caught there. Now reversing course is number three, Moten, and he's going to maybe pick up a yard or two after running plenty of east and
ran
west.
Ran along for a little there, didn't he?
Yeah.
And you know, and Maurer
nice
did
coverage there by
Maurer
the
Maurer did a good job punting, and Kobe Nelson and Ezra Latta and Marcus Johnson doing a good job on the coverage.
So, Cedar, a team in search of a break here.
Yeah, in search of a break and in search of maybe an identity. Sometimes when you change quarterbacks, you kind of sneak one over on Hurricane like we did last week. It'll be interesting to see what the Redmen can do right here as we're down to 4 minutes and 40 seconds left in the third quarter, and the Redmen still have not scored.
And the give over the right side to Mpungi. He's got the edge, and he'll go out of bounds for a first down yardage at about the 39-yard line.
Yeah, and if the referees can't see that Parker Haney was held right there on that edge, they're never going to see that. There is no way that you can block somebody that long and that efficiently out on that edge unless you hold on. And like I said earlier, Pineview holds on, believing that the refs won't call it on every down, and they've proven that they are correct tonight.
Trips to the left this time, first and 10 with the ball at the 38-yard line. Javin swings it out to the left side. It is caught. And tackled there in the open field is number one, Lance Mandrigas, after a pickup of about 4 yards on the play. It's going to be second and six.
Yeah, and Maggio tripping him up, and Jade Bullock and Grant Ritchie coming there to help on the pursuit from the inside. Ritchie from the safety and Jade from the linebacker.
Two split each way this time. And there's the snap to Javins. He'll swing it to the left, and it is caught, no, incomplete, as the ball pops out. They're intended for number eight, Jacob Brand.
Maggio doing a nice job on the coverage, bringing all he had to make sure that the other team's opposing number eight did not catch that one. It would have been interesting how they would have marked that. I don't believe he would have had the first down regardless. As the Redmen giving us a different look, and they're bringing Bailey Gray on the outside edge here. Nope, and he switches back towards the middle.
Third and six for the Panthers. They'll send three out to the right this time. And here's Javins to pass, swings it out, and incomplete, intended for the back out of the backfield in Pungi. Yeah, and he dropped it.
And Brandon Johnson on this near sideline.
Just turning to run too soon.
Yeah, Brandon Johnson out here on this near sideline was all but drugged down by the Panthers. As the Panthers bring their punt team on and the Redmen bring their return team on, we need to catch a break here. It would be nice if we got a snap over the punter's head.
Luke Maggio is back to receive, standing at about his own 26, 27-yard line. And it is number seven, Dylan Hendrickson, in to punt the ball away. So we've seen a couple of punters in the ball game for Pineview, but we haven't seen them punt a lot. One each. Knuckleball punt is caught by Luke at the 30, and he'll be caught by pursuit actually from behind as Luke stepped up in the pocket to catch that ball. And so a return of 3 or 4 yards on the play.
Yeah, and that one made me a little bit nervous as it went high up there out of the lights and then came back down in. And Luke kind of trapped it against his body rather than using his hands on it. And that always makes you nervous when you're watching a player field the ball like that. But Luke steady and caught that and saving good or decent field position as the Redmen will start out almost to the 35-yard line.
First and 10 at the 33 it is for Cedar. And Garrett, the quarterback, will send ball to the right, Barrick to the left. It's a double tight end set.
Peacock in there at the tight end.
Man in motion is ball, and the give is to Travis Tate. He'll get the 35-yard line for a pickup of two.
Yeah, and the outside linebacker there wisely read it, and he just stood there, and Travis had nowhere to run. And Travis says, if you're going to stand there, I'm going to give you all I got. And he laid a licking on number 36, Jacoby Clawson.
So modest pickup of 2 yards, second and eight for the Redmen, but at least as it was with the last possession, they're not headed in a backward direction. And Braden Garrett will bring the offense to the line once again. Ball marked at the near hash. Garrett will keep the ball, step up inside after the edge is taken away, and he'll pick up another 2 yards.
Yeah, they're going to give him 2 yards on that one. So it's going to be third down and six for the Redmen. maybe a play action pass here as Maurer comes into the game, and Travis Tate kind of gingerly runs out of the game, maybe a little bumped and bruised there. Going to be interesting to see if they're going to cover Peacock or not. That might be a good place to go. He's not the long, lean tight end like the other two, so maybe they won't cover him as well.
Braden Garrett and the Redmen looking at a third and six situation, and the jet sweep to Barrick. He was hit in the backfield, and he is maybe going to make it back to the line of scrimmage. Penalty flag comes in late.
And I think you're going to see a face mask call. And it's going to be a five-yard face mask call, so that'll bring up fourth
not
and about
quite
one.
Quite a first down.
Fourth and about one for the Redmen. Fourth and a long one.
So face mask on the defense is the call. A five-yard mark off it's going to be.
The ref kind of anxious there. He acted like he wanted to signal first down.
That brings the ball out to the 42-yard line. And you're right, it's just a little over a yard for the first down.
It's going to be interesting. Looks like the Redmen are going to go.
Yeah, they're going to replay third down then.
And then the Redmen obviously are going to go for it. Replay third down on that penalty. Good break for the Redmen. As that jet was going nowhere. And they're going to discuss it, and I think you might see them call it fourth down.
And discussion on the part of the officials.
And you hear out of the stands, they're saying that he fumbled on the sideline, and I didn't see a fumble. Even if he did, it would have went out of bounds. Redmen would have retained possession on that one. The offense is discussing, the defense is discussing things, the referees are discussing things. See if we come up with a conclusion.
And it's going to be a fourth down.
That's what I thought it should have been all along, was a fourth down. So the Redmen maybe need to rethink this, or maybe should think about this for just a minute. I think, given the time of the game, I'd go for it right here. And it looks like the Redmen are.
Fourth and about a yard and a third. And here's Maurer right up the gut. He's got the first down and more out to the 48-yard line is Trent Maurer.
Yeah, and that's more the kind of run that we're used to seeing by the Redmen. The Redmen may be on that play a little more excited. Maybe the Panthers are a little bit more tired. The Panthers are a little bit more like the Redmen, not as much depth as some of these other schools. They have a large roster, but the majority of the players on this team are sophomores and here just for the experience rather than the actual game time.
They'll spot it closer to the 47-yard line when it's all said and done. First and 10, here's the give to Maurer right up the middle. Once again, he's across the 50-yard line to the 49-yard line of the Pineview Panthers. Pickup of about 4 yards on the play.
And is that, the more I look at this defense the Panthers are running, it's more of an old-fashioned pro-style 3-4 defense rather than a 3-5-3 or a 3-3-5. So it's just a straight 3-4, and they walk their outside linebacker up as kind of a defensive end when there's no one there. Or when there's a tight end, they walk him out on the edge too with Peacock and Parker Haney at the tight ends.
Pineview leads at 12-0 with about a minute left to go here third quarter. Second and six for the Redmen. And two Cedar players running into one another on that jet. And fortunately, Braden Garrett falls on the ball.
Yeah, and it's a good thing that he fell on that ball. Maurer and Barrick just mashed into each other. Or maybe it was Maurer and it was Bullock and Barrick that ran into each other. Garrett wisely, quickly dove on the ball, bringing up third and about nine for the Redmen, just short of midfield.
So a loss of about 3 yards on the fumble. And Barrick split out to the left, Derek Ball to the right. It's Travis Tate to the right of Garrett. And here is Braden Garrett right up the middle. He'll get the 50-yard line on forward progress, but it's going to bring up a fourth at seven.
Yeah, and we're going to see the punt team come on. And I believe Maurer will stay in and do the punting again for the Redmen. It doesn't seem to me that Shem Mackert has been made available for play again.
And that is the end of the third quarter of play. Pineview leads it 12-0. And it's going to be an easy set as the tip of the ball is right on the 50-yard line. They'll just have to swing the ball around to the other side, and we'll be back with the fourth and final quarter play in 1 minute.
Let's face it, buying a pre-owned vehicle can be a challenge. What if you could eliminate all the risk? Where? Cedar City Motor Company. Peace of mind comes in many forms, like the fact that your pre-owned vehicle has a 7-day money-back guarantee, a 30-day exchange policy, and you get one low price, plain and simple, always. And that means a no-regret, mistake-proof car buying experience. Cedar City Motor Company. We're a new company with a new philosophy.
Backcountry TV brings you the hard-hitting action of high school sports. Join us for all the play-by-play action as we spotlight our student-athletes on the gridiron. Backcountry TV and Cherry Creek Radio cover all the live action on game night with playback of all the action every Tuesday and Wednesday at 7 p.m. Watch the Cedar Redmond play on Tuesday at 7 with the action of the Canyon View Falcons on Wednesday at 7. Home or away, Backcountry TV will bring you the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. Redmond Falcons on Backcountry TV.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Ooh, look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920.
Okay, we begin the fourth quarter of play. Cedar set to kick the ball away, and it will be Trent Maurer standing on his own 35-yard line. It's going to be Michael Moten in the deep position to receive at about his own 14. There's the snap. And a nice low end-over-end kick is going to be taken at the 15 by Moten. He's out to the 20, to the 25-yard line. Still in bounds, and he'll make it out to the 30.
Out to about the 30-yard line.
And, you know, these Panthers are not scared to turn and run back the other direction. We saw that last night in the JV game. They got clear to the edge, and he tried to run back towards the other edge on this one as the Redmen are going to need a stop here in a hurry. We need two scores in this fourth quarter.
12-0 Panthers, and it is Pineview ball on its own 30-yard line. First and 10, 11:46 left to go. The fourth quarter just underway here. All alone in the backfield is the quarterback, Javins, and the throw, the fumble, and recovered by the receiver. Number three, Michael Moten. So he caught the ball, made a move, and dropped the ball, and then fell right on it.
You know, and I think we helped him with the drop there. It's too bad we didn't hang on to him a little bit more and not allow him the chance to get back on top of the ball. As we have the referee is conferencing again in the middle of the field.
Perhaps,
and there might be some discussion on whether it was an actual
catch.
Whether
it was an actual catch or not is what I'm thinking. The ball, the pickup is about 7 or 8 yards on the catch, the fumble, and the recovery.
And they're going to call it a catch.
They're calling it a catch, which I believe it was. And it's an 8-yard pickup when it's all said and done, second and two.
And the line shift again for the Panthers as they run three on and three off.
From simple checking to mortgages to financial tools to help your small business, there's no substitute for having the right banking partner, Zions Bank. We haven't forgotten who keeps us in business on the Zions Bank substitution there. Two wide receivers split out to the right and a tight end to the right as well. And here is the give over the right side to Mpungi. The penalty flag comes in, likely a hold out across the 45-yard line and out of bounds at the 47 is Mpungi. He's got the first down, but we'll have to see. It is indeed a hold against the Panthers.
Yeah, and it was Parker Haney that was getting held, and Parker's been held all night long. Glad to see they finally caught that one, and Ray's not correct. Sooner or later, they are going to call holding on you if you hold on every down.
Maybe not every play.
No, they won't call it every down, but sooner or later, they're going to call you.
So the hold, the spot of it is the 37-yard line. So the 10-yard mark off will take it back to the 27. And that's exactly where they're going to put it. Ball marked on the near hash. And as you say, Cleve, these coaches like to keep that boundary side to their own side.
They do. And we have Travis Tate in the game playing the corner, which isn't something we've seen a whole lot of this year, as the Panthers shift even where their linemen are.
It's a second and 12 for the Panthers. They've got to get to the 40-yard line for the first down. And here's Javins. He'll give over the left side to Mpungi. He's hit immediately, but drives his feet forward for a pickup of a couple of yards on the play.
Yeah, and one of those plays where they just smashed into each other and not much of a change, as they bring, the Panthers bring more of what is their receiving core rather than their rushing core back out onto the field.
Third and 12 now. And the ball is at the 28-yard line. So a pickup of just 1 yard after all that, Cleve.
Yeah, a lot for nothing again. And they just kind of move that ball back and forth right there about that 27-yard line.
Three wide receivers split out to the left, one to the right. Mpungi is the running back to the right of Javins. And here's Javins back to pass. Looking to his left, fires, hit hard. As he lets it go, it is dropped. Had a man wide open. But, boy, did Javins get driven to the ground.
Yeah, and that we're kind of
that
fortunate
is,
on that one.
That Quade Murray.
Yeah, that Quade didn't get called for a helmet-to-helmet contact.
It's true.
As he put, you know, and it's not really helmet, it's helmet to chin.
Helmet to chest, yeah.
It put him right in the chin, knocked his head back about as quick as you'll see a head snap back. It looked a little bit like whiplash in a car. But bringing out the punt, and the Redmen time is waning as we're down to 9:50 left in the ball game.
9:50 left to go in the ball game, and the ball game has gone fairly quickly after a bit of a late start because of all the running. And to punt the ball away is Nick English. He'll angle it toward the near sideline, high spiral kick, and it's going to hit and roll. And Luke unable to make the catch, and the penalty flag comes in from the line judge.
Yeah, and that's going to be a hit in the back as Chandler Twitchell was running down the field, and he just got drilled in the back. And so you're going to see the Redmen get the ball about 15 yards further down the field. They might even get a chance for a re-kick on that one, and they're
so,
not.
So personal foul is going to go against the Panthers.
Personal foul against the Panthers.
And you're going to get an opportunity for a re-kick because the possession had not changed on that one. It's going to back him up 15 yards and get a re-kick. And where that ball, Maggio couldn't quite gauge it on his fair catch, and that thing took a really good bounce. Very opportune foul for the Redmen if they, in fact, choose to make him re-kick again.
Here comes the official signal. It looks like they're marching it off from...
They're going to spot it. They're going to call it after a possession.
After the possession.
That's one of those ones that's kind of ambiguous. It's up to kind of a referee's decision whether it was before the possession or in the middle of a possession.
It will be Cedar ball at the 32-yard line. Closer to the 33, I guess.
Helped us out on that.
Where it's going to be first and 10.
Helped us out anyway to get us out of... We would have been trapped inside our own 20.
Ball and Barrick split each way. Barrick is the man in motion. And the pass across the middle, tipped up in the air, falls incomplete. Intended there for, is that Haney?
Yeah, that
Parker
is Haney.
Haney,
it was more of just kind of a jump ball pass. And Haney kind of doing a little boxing out and getting his hands on it, but he couldn't quite bring that down as he may have mistimed his jump. But I don't, if he would have ran one more step, I think he maybe could have got a pass interference call.
Second and 10 for the Redmen at the 33-yard line. 9:32 left to go in this ball game. 12-0 Panthers is your score. And those 12 points came very early in the ball game. Garrett to pass again down the right side. He's got ball. Ball juggles it, finally brings it in. He's to the 30-yard line, the 25. It'll be Cedar ball at about the 24-yard line.
Yeah, and we'd like
Garrett,
we'd like to say he caught it at the 45, but he really juggled it to about the 30.
The catch didn't become official till about the 30-yard line as he juggled it the entire way. And a big first down here for Cedar, as deep as they've been in Pine View territory in this ball game, looking to put their first points on the board. First and 10 for the Redmen at the 24.
And right now, still plenty of time for the Redmen. No need to panic and get excited.
9:15 left to go in the ball game. Plenty of time, 12-0. And here is Tate on the keeper around the right side. Hit and falls forward for a pickup of about 2 yards.
And again, lots of beads bouncing up off the ground as that black rubber on that turf comes up as the Redmen get close to inside the 20-yard line for the first time this evening.
It'll be the 22-yard line, the spot. And it's going to be second down. So a 2-yard pickup there. Second and 8. Garrett with Tate next to him. And a wide receiver split each way. Here's Tate around the left side, finds a seam inside the 15-yard line, carries his tacklers all the way to the 10-yard line. He's got a Bobby's Upholstery first down.
Yeah, and that Bobby's Upholstery first down is going to be marked at the 11-yard line, so the Redmen will have a chance for another first down before the score. It'd be nice just to get the score here in a play or two.
Fourth quarter of the ball game brought to you by Midtown Tire and Auto. Regular service extends the life of your vehicle and gives you better performance and fuel efficiency. Scheduling manufacturer-recommended maintenance at Midtown is an easy way to avoid costly and inconvenient breakdowns. Midtown Tire and Auto, look for the big tire on South Main Street. Trait around the right side, finds the edge. He dives to the pylon, and it is a touchdown. Travis Tate.
The first score of the evening, and the Redmen seem to be really getting the ball marching. They definitely have the energy. They have the momentum. Hopefully that'll hold here as Blake White comes in to kick the field goal.
Blake White Schreiben in for the first time in this ball game since kicking the ball off. Or actually, he didn't kick the Pineview kicked the ball off.
He kicked the ball off at the second half.
Yeah, so he kicked.
He's only been in 2 plays for the game.
So
that's not good news.
Maggio to set the ball down and White Schreiben to kick it through, and it's up and good. And it is a 12-7 score. We'll be back in 1 minute with the kickoff.
And it just got interesting.
Yep.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
At Cedar City Motor Company, our philosophy is simple, honest, upfront pricing for you and your family. That's why we offer one low price, plain and simple, always. Listed clearly on every new Ford, Lincoln, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, Ram, and every pre-owned vehicle. After all, the price on a vehicle shouldn't depend on your ability to negotiate. Cedar City Motor Company, a new company with a new philosophy.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Hey, Backcountry TV, sell my stuff.
Sell my stuff.
Sell my stuff.
If you have a garage full of stuff you don't need anymore and you want to sell or trade your stuff, we have you covered. Using your camcorder or smartphone, send us a video with the items you want to sell. Don't forget to make a sign with your name, phone number, or email address and price. Then email your video to sellmystuff@backcountrytv.net and we'll broadcast your items for free.
Blake White Schreibman to kick it off from the 40-yard line. And it's going to be number 1, Lance Mandriguez, as well as number 6, Jacob Mbungi, to receive. They're standing on about the 7 or 8-yard line. 12-7. We got a ball game here, Cleve.
Absolutely.
8:04 left to go.
Plenty
of time. I think
we'll see another squib kick here.
Here's the kick, and it is a low squib kick that's going to hit and roll. It's picked up at the 15 there by Mandriguez, and he'll bring it out to the 20, across the 20, and struggle to the 25, and that's where Pineview will begin.
Good kick coverage there for the Redmen. Hopefully we can hold them a three and out again and take this ball and score. 7:55 left in the ball game. We have time now, but if they get a couple first downs, it's going to make it a little bit difficult for the Redmen.
Penalty flag on the 30-yard line, far side. I believe it is, but I don't know if it was intentionally dropped.
They're a little more discussed.
They're going to put it right on the 30.
There is a flag on the far side of the field.
And they're talking to the Redmen, so I think we're going to back that one up to about the 20.
Block in the back against the Pineview Panthers is going to take it back 10 yards from the spot. The spot is the 30-yard line. And the official was careful to mark that spot, but they're going to actually take it back to the 15. The ball didn't come out that far. The ball didn't come out only to the 25-yard line, so that's where they're going to mark it off from. The Panthers lead at 12-7, 7:55 left to go in this ball game. Javins is the quarterback, a junior, 6'1", 168 pounds. And here's the snap and the give to the running back.
Fumble.
And the Redmen have it.
Parker Haney dove on that one.
Parker Haney with the recovery, and the Redmen have the ball
on the 15-yard line.
17-yard line of Pineview, and a chance here to really turn everything around in this ball game.
Change the whole bit of the game. And we're at 7:50 left, almost maybe a little too fast. Hopefully the Redmen will take a little bit of time before we give the ball back to the Panthers and not score quickly. But of course, if I have my choice of scoring quickly or not scoring a ball, I'll take scoring quickly every time.
And I think, well, I'll wait for this play. Barrick is the man in motion, and it's the keeper right up the middle, inside the 15 to the 10-yard line is Braden Garrett. Pickup of 7 yards on the play. I was going to say, Cleve, I think I've been misidentifying a Pineview player for the entire game.
And who's
there
that?
There are two number sevens, and Dylan Hendrickson is the wide receiver.
The first time you called it, you called him Dylan Hendrickson.
Yeah.
And then the other times you called him the other. And so I almost made that same
mistake. I apologize for that. That's the trick of having two players with the same number.
And we're just going to go because one's listed at 6'6".
The Tate is the ball carrier right up the middle, inside the 10 to about the 8.
And just short of the first down for the Redmen.
About a yard short of a first down.
And Redmen have the emotion. They have the intensity going right here. The Panthers seem a little flat,
They've also got the clock running.
A little on their heels. The Redmen doing what they need to do to bring this game into their control.
Travis Tate, the running back, to the left of Braden Garrett. It's Derek Ball split out to the right and Barrick to the left. Here's the snap and a give to Tate once again, and he'll head it up
and he's
north
got the first
and south.
Down.
And he's got the first down east of the 5-yard line. And, you know, Travis, we've seen him a couple of times in this ball game trying to find that edge and losing some yardage. But in this series especially, he's done a great job to plant and head right upfield.
Yeah, and his periphery is kind of seeing that hole and heading towards it. And you like to see that in the running back, Chris. You're absolutely correct on that one.
So it's going to be first and goal for the Redmen at the 5-yard line. Same formation, except that Tate is to the right of Braden this time. Tate inside the 5 to the 3. Job of running there, keeping his hands on the ball.
And drug down there by Dylan Hendrickson, number 7.
There you go.
And he is
once again,
he's a tall young man.
He is
6'6".
6'6" and 200 pounds. And my apologies to Dylan and his mother.
Well, I'll bet his mother's here, and I'll bet she's never listened to our radio station. So maybe our apologies will fall on deaf ears.
Second and goal from about the 4, I guess, is where they finally mark the ball, Cleve. Braden Garrett, the quarterback, low snap, and is picked up by the running back. Maurer, and he'll bang forward and pick up a couple of yards on the play. That ball hit Brayden Garrett in the knees, bounced right up, and catching it right on the fly was Trent Maurer. He says, I don't want to lose yards on this play, and he took it down to the two-yard line.
Yeah, and the Redmen in that double tight formation running to the left side there behind Peacock and Berenson and Hayden Giles. We'll see where the Redmen go again as we have Maurer to the left of Garrett this time with a double tight formation.
And look for it straight ahead with Maurer. There is the give to Maurer. He's got a hole. He's into the end zone for a touchdown.
And that brings the score to 14-12. If the kick will make 13-12. The kick will make it 14-12. I think I might would go for two just because the one doesn't make a bit of difference. If you bring it to two, means they have to score a touchdown to beat you.
And timeout called by Cedar to think about it. Timeout brought to you by Cedar City Chamber of Commerce. It's time for you to log in and check out all the great benefits of being a member of the Chamber of Commerce. Visit cedarcitychamber.org. Back in 1 minute.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Ooh, look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920.
13-12 is your State Bank score with 4:53 left to go in this ball game, and Cedar is going to bring the offense out and go for two. Cleve.
Yeah, and that's exactly what they need to do. Maybe a little play action pass here and try to hit Parker on a jump ball underneath the goal post.
Garrett with Travis Tate to his left. And the give is to Tate. He'll head it upfield. He's close, but no good.
Nope. Stopped about a half yard short. And, you know, Panthers celebrate all they want. They're still behind. We've got an injury report on Shem Mackert. He has a sprained ankle. Not a bad one. Hopefully he'll be healed up and be able to move into that three-man rotation at tight end and be our punter again next week in our playoff game wherever we may be. And hoping this score holds and we'll be at home.
Ladies and gentlemen, please note the trash cans that have been placed around the stadium. We would ask that you place all trash in these receptacles to help keep our school facilities clean. Thank you for your support.
So, Cedar to kick the ball away, Blake Weitschreiben staying warm in the second half, isn't he?
He is. We didn't see much of him early, but we've seen quite a bit of him late here. And hopefully the Redmen will get some good coverage. I'd like to see, hey, let's hope for a fumble on this kickoff, right?
Always a Cedar fan, aren't you, Cleve?
Hey, we always got to be wish for the best. My dad took me to my first Redmen game in 1975.
Here comes the kick, and it is taken, and boy, right up through the heart of the defense and out across the 35-yard line to the 39 is number one. And that is Lance Mandriguez.
And Lance Mandriguez didn't field the ball. One of the upbacks did, and he turned around to toss the ball back to Lance. And that kind of took the Redmen by surprise as they were all converging. All converging on that upback, and they had to change their angle of pursuit. But, you know, the Panthers have about 62 yards to go for a touchdown and 4 minutes and 44 seconds left to do it.
First and 10 for the Panthers. Back to pass is Javins.
Hold him in bounds. Get him in bounds.
He's knocked out of bounds at about the 49-yard line. So a big pickup there for a first down, and the clock stops.
One of the things when you're in this situation on defense, you think, oh, we can't let him score. Let's just shut him down like we've always done and not change what we're doing as we're bringing Bailey out on the far outside in the coverage. And this is going to be interesting because this is a coverage that maybe Coach Espeland didn't want to run.
At the 49-yard line, back to pass once again is Javins, now rolling out to his left, looking downfield, and just throws it at the feet of his intended receiver, number 16, Hudson Reed.
Yeah, an experienced quarterback there, just getting rid of it, throwing it at the ground. You know, obviously intentional to not throw it to anybody, but when you throw it right at the feet of your own guy, who has turned to block, intentional grounding.
The ball is in Cedar territory by a yard at the 49-yard line. It's going to be second and 10 for the Panthers. Two wide receivers split each way, and a running back to the left of Javins in Mpungi. And here comes Javins, back to pass once again, caught, and on his knees was number one Lance Mandriguez for a pickup of about 8 yards on the play. That'll bring the ball down to the 41-yard line, third and 2.
And he caught that right in between three red men. He caught it there between Bailey Gray and Jade Bullock.
Clock running, 3:57 and counting. And third and 2. Javins up under center momentarily to give some instructions. Now back in the shotgun position. Same formation, two wide receivers split each way. And he'll tuck the ball away as he sees a hole, but he's tripped up just a bit, and he'll get back get to the line of scrimmage and pick up a yard, but that's still going to be a yard short of first down.
Yeah, Johnson there on the trip up. You know, I don't know if anyone realizes how fortunate we are. Bailey Gray and Jade Bullock are in the top 5 in tackles for the state. We've never had two guys of their quality, but they are as night and day different as can be as we have
fourth
a short
and
punt
one
situation.
Big play here. Javins out of the power eye, and he's got the first down. And Mpungi is down to the 41-yard line. So with about 3 yards to spare, the Panthers have the first down. 3:06 left to go in the game.
And Bullock and Gray again on that tackle. And like I was saying, never have two players been more different in personality than those two.
And same formation. Power eye stacked to the right. And a fumble. And it's a loose ball. Who's got this
Maybe
ball?
Maybe Parker Haney again.
Cedar says they have it.
But they're calling it
but,
down.
But it's going to be down for Pineview.
And that was very fortunate enough. For
loss of
for
about a yard on the play.
And they're going to give up on their power eye look and bring their regular offense back out onto the field.
The clock is running.
2:30 in county.
And two wide receivers are split each way now for Javins. And once again, just one running back in the backfield. Here's Javins back to pass, looking, fires. The ball was tipped, I thought. It's caught out in the left flat. And Mpungi will get the first down and get out of bounds. All the way inside the 25-yard line to the 24.
Yeah, just a blown coverage there. No one had Mpungi. No one. We're fortunate enough that the Redmen were able to get off their guys and come over there. But when he caught that ball, there was no one within about 20 yards of him. We were fortunate they did not score. 2:08 and a first down on the 25-yard line.
So the ball at the 24, first and 10 for the Panthers. Here is Javins back to pass, fires it, and it is in and out of the hands of his intended receiver, number 3, Michael Moten.
And Daniel Jordan running him down from behind on that one. On that one right there where he would have caught that at the line of scrimmage, you really wish that he would have caught that, and then the clock would have continued to run. But the incomplete pass stops the clock with 2:03 left in the ballgame.
2:03 and a second and 10 for the Panthers with the ball at the Cedar 24-yard line, I should say. Three wide receivers split out to the right side this time. One
maybe
to the
a little
left.
Too cushion there by... Scoot up a little bit, Grant Ritchie. You don't need to be 15 yards deep on this one.
And here's Javins back to pass once again. Fires it. It's caught inside the 5-yard line at the 3 by Mandriguez.
How do you be 15 yards back and let them run by you. And let them run by you, and they catch that one. That is unbelievable. I don't know how you do that.
So the Panthers knocking at the door, 156, 155 left to go. And the Power Eye formation once again to go for two. Actually, it hits for the touchdown. And into the end zone goes Mukungi for the touchdown.
Bringing our score to 19-13. And I think you'll see the Panthers go for two right here.
So Mukungi scores it, and it's 18-13.
Yeah, 18-13, excuse me.
With 1:40 left to go in this ball game, and the Panthers have recaptured the lead.
Trying to make it a 7-point lead here instead of just 5 or 6.
And indeed, they will go for two. And here's the snap to Javins. Javins back to pass, looking in the end zone, fires it to the right side, incomplete.
So the Redmen only need to score with a minute 40 seconds left in the game, and 6 points would give them the win.
We will take a pause for 1 minute and be back with the kickoff. 1:40 left, Panthers lead it 18-13.
Let's face it, buying a pre-owned vehicle can be a challenge. What if you could eliminate all the risk? Where? Cedar City Motor Company. Peace of mind comes in many forms, like the fact that your pre-owned vehicle has a 7-day money-back guarantee, a 30-day exchange policy, and you get one low price, plain and simple, always. And that means a no-regret, mistake-proof car buying experience. Cedar City Motor Company. We're a new company with a new philosophy.
Backcountry TV brings you the hard-hitting action of high school sports. Join us for all the play-by-play action as we spotlight our student-athletes on the gridiron. Backcountry TV and Cherry Creek Radio cover all the live action on game night with playback of all the action every Tuesday and Wednesday at 7 p.m. Watch the Cedar Redmond play on Tuesday at 7 with the action of the Canyon View Falcons on Wednesday at 7. Home or away, Backcountry TV will bring you the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. Redmond Falcons on Backcountry TV.
Look at those toys.
Insurance must be expensive.
Nah.
I bet he's got an Allstate agent. They can save you up to 30% more by bundling your policies.
Well, his dog's stupid.
Poodles are one of the world's smartest breeds. Bundle and save with an Allstate agent. Are you in good hands?
In Cedar City, your local Allstate insurance agency is the Mike Haight Insurance Agency. Call 435-775-1920.
Buying and selling real estate is a process with many steps involved to complete a transaction. That's why ERA Realty Center in Cedar City makes it as simple and straightforward as possible with well-trained and knowledgeable professionals. To find out more about your neighborhood, your new home search, or selling your house, contact an ERA Realty Center professional. Visit online at cedarcityera.com. For buying or selling, visit ERA Realty Center at 259 West 200 North in Cedar City or call 586-2777.
Panther fans, give it up for our cheerleaders.
Cedar with a chance, 1:40 left. They trail it now 18-13 after the touchdown, and here comes the kick. It's going to be a long kick into the end zone. 20-yard line is where Cedar will need to begin.
I think that one went past the end line on that one. That was a heck of a kick. Redmen will have 80 yards and a minute and 40 seconds to do it.
.140 left to go, 18-13, and Cedar with a first and 10 on its own 20-yard line. Barrick will split out to the left. Derek Ball split out to the right. And Travis Tate is the running back to the left of Braden Garrett. Double tight end set. Garrett back to pass, looking. The screen is set up, and he threw it short, incomplete to Ball.
And kind of had a double screen look going here as Travis Tate came out to this side, maybe seeing if the Panthers would bite on that.
1:35 left to go, 18-13 Panthers. Second and 10 for the Redmen. Same formation, and same personnel. And here is Garrett. Rolling to his right, fires to the right. It is caught, and Derek Ball's got the first down.
He did not get out of bounds.
But he did not get out of bounds.
And they're winding the clock, and they need to hurry and get up there.
They'll set the chains and then wind the clock.
First down, Redmond.
And they have the clock stop, still stopped, and now they wind it.
And Cedar coming to the line of scrimmage with the same formation as before. Here's Garrett, same thing, rolling to his right. Now he'll come back to his left, and he'll just throw it up, and it'll be caught by Barrick. He'll get out of bounds with no gain. He may have actually lost. It would have been better off just dropping the ball.
Yeah, either way, but we got out of bounds, and so nothing bad happened on that one.
Yep, but no gain on the play. He went right out of bounds at the line of scrimmage.
And a minute 14 left in the ball game, and the Redmen have the clock stopped. And, you know, Garrett's a great kid, but he's not a throwing quarterback. He doesn't have a great arm, and a little banged up.
Penalty flag over on the far side. It's going to go against Cedar holding. So that is a tough, tough break.
Well, as much running around as Garrett was doing, there's no doubt you get that call.
So that'll be a 10-yard mark off.
And I've just been informed that they did not flip the coin beforehand, and so we have no idea. You'll have to read it in the paper, folks.
First down, repeat first down, but 20 yards to go for the first down, and there's less than a minute and counting. And now they've stopped the clock.
We have a timeout, I believe, or we're arguing about how much time's left on the clock, and they're going to ask to reset it. Let's see what the referee wants. Oh, sideline warning on the Redmen.
Sideline warning on the Redmen.
The referee's ears apparently have heard enough for one evening.
Now they'll roll the clock, and Braden Garrett will bring the offense to the line. 52 and counting. Man in motion is Barrick. He's going to throw. Now he can't find an open man, so he'll just head back the other way, and he'll toss it to Garrett. Garrett will get out of bounds. So in the end, it's a pickup of about 5 yards, but a lot of time off the clock.
Yeah, not exactly the way Coach drew it up, but Barrick, a good presence of mind to keep that play going and get it to Garrett and get the clock stopped. 38.4 seconds left, and barring a miracle, this is going to be the final score of our ball game this evening.
18-13 Panthers. They'll roll the clock. He apparently didn't get out of bounds. Here's Garrett, looking to pass, fires to the right side. It's caught by Ball, and he's not going to get out of bounds.
He should have just turned and ran out of bounds rather than try to get upfield, and the Redmen have to use a timeout. With 16.2 seconds. A ball came flying up there on the sideline. I thought for a second that it was a flag. But 16.2, and that would make it
on the play.
66 yards.
So a penalty flag looks like it's going to go against face mask on the Panthers. And it's a personal foul face mask.
15 yards, that'll help us out.
That's going to bring the ball out close to midfield.
15 yards, an automatic first down.
They will spot the ball right at the 50-yard line, first and 10 for the Redmen.
And maybe we will have a miracle. Garrett doesn't quite have enough.
But they're rolling the clock once again.
Garrett does not quite have enough time.
And now they've called a timeout. So a timeout called, 13.2 seconds, and we're going to keep it right here.
And it's going to be after a quick play for the Redmen to get a chance for two right here. An incomplete pass, they maybe could have two plays, but maybe just one as the referee is signaling, put some more time on the clock. I think we're going to see they want 14.
Our post-game wrap is coming up, made possible by Five Buck Pizza, offering late-night pizza in Cedar City, dine-in, takeout, or delivery. Brad's Food Hut, soon with two Cedar City locations to serve you. And Bullock Drug and Township Pharmacies, your hometown independent pharmacies. Don't forget about the old-fashioned soda fountain at Bullock Drug on the Main Street. 15 seconds they're going to put. And we should be back in action here in just a moment. Right on the 50-yard
line. The referee was under the assumption that the guys with the headsets were in here with the clock guy, and they're not. We have a much better chance of being able to see what the referees are signaling with their fingers than hearing what the guys are saying up above us.
So here we go, 15 seconds left to go. 18-13, Pine View leads it after the touchdown a moment ago. And here's the snap to Braden Garrett, and the give on the double reverse. And here is Derek Ball to throw. He throws it downfield, incomplete. And 6.8 seconds remain.
And we do get a pass interference
There's
call.
There's a pass interference call.
And that's going to put
down
the ball
at the 20-yard line.
On the 35-yard line with 6.8 seconds left in the ball game. And I don't know that the Redmen have another trick play. They've ran their jet pass. They ran the reverse pass. And so now we're gonna see exactly what the call is. Regardless whether it's on the Redmen or on the Panthers, we're going to see one more play.
There are two penalty flags, one at about the 32-yard line, the other at the point of the pass. It could be the same penalty, just with the other penalty coming in from the side judge. We'll see. Personal foul.
Helmet to helmet.
Helmet to helmet. And
unsportsmanlike
conduct, it looks like.
So that could be 30 yards for the Redmen. And here comes the referee as he bravely walks towards the sideline.
Ray Hosner.
And Ray is not one bit happy. I'm sure in his best New York Italian accent, he is letting him have it as that ball is going to go all the way to the 20-yard line.
Wow. So two penalties on top of one another, Cleve?
Yeah, you don't see that very often in a varsity ball game.
But one was a dead ball foul.
One was a dead ball foul. So maybe... young man used some of his not so nice language, because we have one play from the 20-yard line and we got to have a referee.
So it's going to be one play, 6.8 seconds. Cedar has the ball on the Pineview 20-yard line.
Making it exciting.
Yeah, it is.
Kind of a sloppy miracle.
Braden Garrett, the quarterback. And here comes the snap. Garrett back to pass, rolling to his left now, trying to get out of trouble. Squares up, fires it into the end zone, and it is
incomplete. And that's the ball game.
That's the ball game. Pineview wins it 18-13.
Oh, we have a flag on the field.
There's a penalty flag on the field.
We have a flag, and I think it's going to be a holding. And the ball can end on an offensive penalty, but it can't end on a defensive penalty.
Likely from the position of the flag, it's a holding penalty. And Pineview is celebrating, and the ball game is over. Pineview has won it 18-13. And that is your final score, and you're listening to the post-game wrap.